Help you? By only voting for candidates dedicated to expanding government. It's easy. You don't need to study the issues. No matter what a politician says when running for office, they're all dedicated to expanding government. And make sure you tell all your friends and family to vote for more government. Here at CatMuff, we don't care if you vote Democrat or Republican, as long as you vote for candidates committed to growing our federal family. CatMuff. Because folks just aren't smart enough to handle real freedom.
This is Free Talk Live. You can dial toll-free, and you can bring up anything that you want to discuss. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. And, of course, you can join us online anytime over at freetalklive.com. You can join us via Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. Joining you in studio, it's Ian here.
Cantwell.
Oh, Cantwell, hang on a second. Something screwy here with your microphone. Did you hear him at all when he said that? I did not. All right,
no,
stand
I don't
by.
Hear it.
We'll work on that here in a moment. Cantwell is here with us, and we will figure
and
out
he's out for the segment.
What the hell is going on with his microphone here in just a moment. So, Mark, we've actually got a special guest to start out the program. We've been talking about Cameron Hughes wine for
like a
couple
month.
Weeks now.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's been a month.
Something
quite
close
yet,
to
but,
that.
2 or 3 weeks, I think, at least. And we had a great wine tasting here at the Keene Activist Center recently. So you actually wanted to bring Cameron on because prohibition isn't really over yet, is it?
No, I had a conversation with Cameron when I was talking to him about getting our shipping code and that sort of thing. He was very kind regarding that. But one of the things he started doing was telling me what it's like to try to send wine around America because I knew that it couldn't be easy. Cameron?
It's gotten a lot easier, but it's taken 70, 80 years post-prohibition to get us here, maybe 90 years. It is a very complicated task that actually requires, you have to have an outside agency to help you run the compliance that helps you ship wine to a bunch of different states.
Yeah, I mean, so I think that what people probably don't realize when they're enjoying a beer or a glass of wine or whatever is that there's this whole sort of created system back there that was basically put together sometime in like the 30s, maybe the on into the 40s, that really was it's archaic at this point today.
Yeah, absolutely. So, all right. So Prohibition ends 1933. And what really drove a lot of the Prohibition sentiment was what you called tied house. And that's where you had a beer supplier primary or whiskey supplier that also owned the outlet to serve that item. So
yeah.
That's a tied house, right? And so after Prohibition, every state was left to its own to enact its own liquor laws. And to this day, you still have, basically I say all of us wine folks out here in California, we export to 50 different countries called the United States. And because each one has its own laws, and there's still dry counties all over the place, Texas and down through the South.
Mean that you can't ship to a dry county or only that
you can't drink in those places? You can't buy alcohol.
Wow, I didn't realize you couldn't even drink in the dry county. I knew you couldn't buy alcohol, but I mean, I know that everybody just sort of drives to the store in the next county over and then drives home. You're saying it's
They do. Nobody's going into anybody's house, with their gendarmes and saying, "Hey, we saw you doing a shot through the window." But
will you not ship to the dry counties? I'm just curious.
Yeah, no, we can't.
Wow.
In fact, there's a whole computer system that monitors. So when someone comes into our website and say wanted to order some wine, there's a back end that monitors every zip code and tells you whether you can ship there or not.
Amazing.
Yeah. And where I was headed was this is all kind of left over from the post-prohibition environment. And distributors, I'd say probably 20, 30 years ago, there were probably 7,000 or 8,000 beer, wine, and liquor distributors here in the country.
Okay.
And now there are about 700.
Wow.
And so you can see how it's flip-flopped. And at the same time, there were maybe 700 wineries 20, 30 years ago, and now there are 8,000. And so you can see the difficulty. Go to Texas, for instance. There are effectively two distributorships that run 85, 90% of the volume of the state
Wow.
through their warehouses. Yeah, and you know, everybody else is a small little entity that scraps for whatever's left over.
So let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Usually in the marketplace, a person wants to do business with another person. So I wish to drink wine. I come to you. I wish to have wine. Now, in the post-prohibition America, there's people in between. Who are the people besides the distributors that are in between? Those are the people that are really sort of just milking the system. They're not really creating anything inside the system. They're not producers and they're not consumers. So who are those?
That's right.
Who are those people?
Well, those folks are big. You know, they started out as family companies, and to this day, they're all privately held. But they're massive billion-dollar operations that have consolidated over, as you can see, going from 8,000 down to 700. But realistically, there are seven massive national distribution organizations that all the product gets filtered through. And they're, you know, Southern Wines and Spirits out of Florida. It's the Glazer family out of Texas. And, you know, they're big, massive billion-dollar companies that stay totally under the radar when it, you know, like I said, they're privately held.
Got it. So this is basically it's distributors that are sort of skimming off the top and getting the extras. Obviously, the government gets some kind of tax on at least liquors. I've seen stamps across them.
Well, the distributors are mandated to be there by law, right? Like the, you
that's
can't
right.
Cut
so
them
that's
out.
The post-prohibition environment that we were talking about. Every state had to run its own beer, wine, and liquor, but you have to sell in every state. I have to sell to a distributor to sell to a retailer, right? So those guys were put in place primarily to get the mobsters who basically exploded under Prohibition.
Yeah.
You know, the whole organized crime syndicates were born out of Prohibition. Not born out of, but really saw a massive opportunity, right?
Yeah.
And so the Tide House laws and the local control of distributorships were put in place to effectively keep those folks out. And it worked out really, really well. But, you know, we've come to a point in history where, you know, the government can collect taxes on internet shipments, et cetera. But distributors still do have a lock on selling any wine to a licensee retailer in any particular state. Or you still have situations like Pennsylvania and Utah where the government still runs the import and distribution mechanisms for all alcohol.
Let me ask you about Tide houses. So these Tide houses, this is spelled like tying a shoe. So you're
that's right, T-I-E-D.
Yeah. So your alcohol's tied to the distributor, the retail
actually,
outlet.
The producer would own the retail outlet.
It sounds like the
right?
radio business where they have what's called owned and operated, where these big radio companies have syndication arms where they have these national shows, and then they have radio stations that they just cram down all their national shows on, regardless
right.
Of the merits.
That's right. So in these cases, this would have been what basically came up out of the free market. Tell me what was wrong with these Tide houses.
Well, the problem you had, like, say, in the 1910s, the 1920s, was the Tide houses were pushing so much volume through, and probably irresponsibly so. So the dries, right, the folks that the Protestants that were, you know, morally against alcohol in any way, shape, or form,
yep.
you know, used the image of the drug supplier, so to speak, you know, pushing it on their victims. And so that's what the Tide houses were. And, you know, you still have them. They exist in Britain. I mean, Guinness owns thousands of pubs. Right in Britain, so that's a Tide house where you own the outlet.
So
now,
basically, they were moving volume. They were being successful at marketing beer.
That's right.
Okay,
and the image was one of them, like you know, to the dries, of course, as a drug dealer, right?
Yeah,
similar to the situation we have today, you know, where you've got millions of people in prison because they had some pot on them or something.
I also saw the Ken Burns film where Prohibition, where they were talking about these Tide houses being used in political campaigns. I guess the politicians would come in and maybe pay for all the alcohol for the evening or something like that, and essentially buy their votes. But I don't really think that has anything to do with
anything. And it still happens to this day.
How so?
Well, I think you've got distributors maintain their power in markets in large part by, you know, they've been supporting politicians and political political enterprise in their various markets for a long, long time. They're some of the biggest donors.
Cameron, hold that thought. We're going to come back more on post-prohibition America here in moments. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. If you've got a question for Cameron, he's in the business, and he knows a lot about it. 855-450-FREE or Skype, Free Talk Live.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
It takes a lot of courage to face your own death. But I'm glad I finally did. See, I was putting off getting life insurance to protect my family, even though I knew it was important. Then my neighbor's husband died. I watched her struggle emotionally and financially. It really made me face reality. If my husband died, how would I pay the mortgage, the car payments, or keep up the life the kids and I had? I realized I needed to get us life insurance right away. So I called AIG Direct. In less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing my family has protection.
Call AIG Direct right now for a free, no-obligation quote. The call takes less than 5 minutes, and you can save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-463-9184. That's 1-800-463-9184. 1-800-463-9184.
On the average, Americans work between 45 to 50 years, hoping to build up enough wealth to retire and live out their golden years. Unfortunately, with taxation, the rising cost of food, energy, housing, and medical, many retirees are forced to live below the poverty line. Is this a flaw of free enterprise, or is our monetary unit we call the Federal Reserve Note forcing us into perpetual debt, ensuring inflation and higher taxes? These questions and more can be answered by reading G. Edward Griffin's book, The Creature from Jekyll Island. Congressman Ron Paul states it's what every American needs to know about central bank power. A gripping adventure into the secret world of international banking cartel. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. I will give a silver dollar from the early 1900s to anyone who purchases this book. Call 1-800-686-2237 and order a copy today. It's critical that the public be made aware of the system. Call and order your copy today at 1-800-686-2237. That's 1-800-686-2237.
Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenevention. Keenevention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenevention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenevention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenevention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenevention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special early bird price of just $50 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $50 price only lasts through the end of June, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenevention.info. Visit keenevention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenevention.info. Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Shiny badges on your jacket, shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write worms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
We're back with more Free Talk Live. Plenty of time for your calls and thoughts about whatever's on your mind. Coming up, the Bitcoin price seems to have dropped on an event. Now, it's pretty hard to get the Bitcoin price to drop when something happens in the world, but it did happen just over the last 24 hours, apparently, with the loss of one of the world's most popular underground marketplaces. We'll talk more about that. It's kind of a Vice night so far here on Free Talk Live. We've actually got Cameron Hughes on the line with us here. We're going to bring him back on for
Hookers at Hour 9.
More discussion of, we don't do 9 hours, but I think you mean the 9 p.m.
hour. 9 p.m. time. Sorry.
Yeah, so we've got Cameron Hughes, who we've been talking about over the last couple of weeks. He's the guy that goes to the different vineyards, fancy vineyards, and buys essentially their extra stock, relabels it under his own label, his own private label, by lot number, and then sells it to you for a fraction of the price you'd pay those fancy vineyards for the same wine. So you're getting what is normally $70 to $100 bottles of wine for $15 to $25, from what I understand, over at chwine.com. And we've actually got Cameron with us. So am I right on that range? Like, what's the low end? What's the high end of what people will pay for a wine over at chwine.com?
Well, there's a couple different examples. So we do, let's say on the high end, Cabernet, there's lot 525 is a Stagecoach M Block. Stagecoach Vineyard M Block Cabernet, guys sell anywhere from $135 to $175 a bottle. We pulled the same fruit, made it ourselves. We sell it for $29. There's a Meteor Vineyard Cabernet on there for sells for $135 if you buy three. And we sell the same fruit vinified at a high-end custom crush facility for $29. And then you'll find everything from, you know, $40 quality Carneros, big oaky buttery rich Chardonnays for $18 that would normally cost you in between $32 and $40.
So what
and,
are you?
And again, it's all about removing the middleman.
Maybe I misunderstood. I didn't realize you guys were making your own wine. I thought you were buying extra wine from these other companies.
Yeah, and that's at the high end, and we do. So that's the bulk of our business. But at the highest end of the price spectrum, we're actually buying fruit from these super, super high-end vineyards and actually making wine at someone else's winery, right? The bulk of, like, Lot 555, I think I've got one pallet left. It's on the website. That's from a very high-end Rutherford producer. We bought 10,000 gallons of wine from them. It was a big vintage in 2012, and they're a big but high-end producer of $100-plus bottles of wine. And we bought the wine, we bottle it, and we ship it to you for a fraction of the price. And Napa Cab's where we can really add a lot of value because those wines are so expensive.
You do get most of your wines from California, right?
Yeah, we do. But we do some imports. We've stayed out of it just because of the very expensive euro, but now it's looking a lot more attractive.
Yeah.
I think a lot more attractive.
Well, don't worry. The euro is going to continue to crash. That's a mess over there.
Yeah, that's my guess, too. I've kind of been hoping for it, maybe against everyone else's better interest. But, you know, I've always seemed ridiculous to me that their currency should be at 145 to the dollar.
Let me ask you this. So I've kind of wondered since I've been doing these ads, when you go to these wineries and you know you're trying to get their overstocks of these high end wines, do they look at you like the cowboy with the white hat riding in to save them, or the undertaker coming in to like you know show them their own mortality? I mean, they
no,
should have been able to sell
the
all
hat.
These.
Absolutely, the cowboy with the white hat.
Okay.
You know, it's I was once compared by a fellow vintner to kind of a vulture. And but he said, you know, Cameron, it was a compliment. And, you know, vultures are necessary to keep the environment free from disease, et cetera. And the disease that I take care of is oversupply. You know, you were talking about an agricultural product. We had short vintages in 10 and 11 and shortages of wine. Now we're back into where we've got three big healthy harvests in a row. And everybody's looking for outlets like, my gosh, you know, I make 15,000 cases of high-end Napa Cab. I've got 20,000 from each vintage. I like to control how much goes into the marketplace so I don't have to go work too hard, number one. But number two, I don't want to have to lower my price. So I'm going to sell 5,000 cases worth of wine off to Cameron over here, and he's going to solve my problem for me.
How long have you been doing this?
About 13 years now. I think it was 2001 I started.
Is it a special license you need to be able to send fermented grape juice through the mail?
It is. Yeah, absolutely. So we've been licensed as a producer of wine because we do make wine at facilities. And that gives me the right to ship to about 41 or 42 states now, whereas 5-7 years ago, it was about 20. So it's opened up considerably.
That's good to know.
Yeah, just out of curiosity, what are some of these states that you can't ship to?
You can't ship to Utah. Can't ship to Pennsylvania. You can't ship to the Dakotas.
No product whatsoever can leave your facility and go to those states.
That's correct, unless the state buys it themselves. And New Hampshire, I can ship to. They just want to track everything that comes in there. And so they do track it. Yeah, they track everything. In Texas, if you order more than two cases of wine in a month, Texas will send me a note and send you a note and say you've exceeded your quantity of wine that you're allowed to purchase this month.
Is they're worried not about that you'll drink too much, but they're worried that you'll be selling it under the table, I presume.
That's part of it, yeah. And, you know, the distributors, of course, have, you know, worked with their local congressional representatives to make sure, or state representatives, to make sure that, that there's no one doing that. And somebody was doing that with very high-end wines in Philadelphia and got recently caught with a whole cellar full of wine that he was then re-retailing out. But that's the only time it's ever happened that I know of.
This just sounds like such a huge pain in the neck. I mean, we've been saying on the show, we've got the promo code we've been giving out that they get free shipping from you if
FTL.
They use it.
Code FTL at
chwine.com. Code FTL at chwine.com, and they get free shipping. And even before this conversation, I was saying to my fellow hosts here, I was saying, this is impossible. There's no way he could give you the cheap wine and then give you the cheap shipping on top of it. And then you come on here and you tell me what a pain in the neck it is to ship this stuff around. You've got a special interface in the back end and Texas is sending you letters and you've got threats from government agencies. I mean, it's crazy.
Happened. Absolutely. Yeah. And we've got cease and desist letters from all sorts of places.
I'd like to say thank you for your service and your dedication.
Go to SilkRoadWines.com. You know, I can't take a lot of the credit for it. It was Jennifer Granholm, the governor of Michigan, who sought to put all these crazy restrictions in place on shipping wine in there. And a coalition of California wineries took her to court. And they won. They're the ones that secured the right to do this. So it's the wineries. Advocacy.
This guy's like the next Ross Ulbricht.
Yeah, I'd have no idea who that is, but I'll take that as a compliment.
He's the guy from the Silk Road.
Yes.
Let me ask you, what's the cost to ship one of these? We got a case of like six bottles of wine, and I just thought to myself, this has to have been, you know, quite a bit to ship.
Yeah, and it costs about $36 for me, just FedEx ground rate to ship a case across the country, right? So, and then it's about $6 in packaging and then another $5 or $6 in just overhead, right? So it's very expensive to ship this stuff across the country. And we're one of the biggest shippers out there. We ship tens of thousands of cases of wine direct to consumer. You know, it costs us that much. And if you're a small winery,
Cameron,
you only ships 1,000
we are
packages.
Really short on time, but it's been great having you on. Really informative. chwine.com. The discount code for free shipping, limited time, is FTL. And I think it's been great. Thanks for coming on Free Talk
Live. Thank you.
Hey, guys, my pleasure. It's been a real fantastic time, too, here.
More coming up.
Now you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoin by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
The Subway restaurant chain has reacted with shock this week after executives discovered that many customers are apparently purchasing footlong sandwiches and eating the entire 12 inches by themselves. A spokesperson for the company addressed reporters this morning.
This is not how our products are intended to be consumed. Our footlong subs have always been meant to be shared among two or more friends. Eating an entire foot of food shouldn't be possible for most people, but they've been doing it somehow, and it needs to stop.
To encourage healthier eating habits, Subway is clarifying its marketing, adjusting language on menus, and in television commercials like this one.
$5 footlongs? Wow, that's $2.50 per person.
Subway's corporate leadership says they were horrified to learn of the misunderstanding.
It's frightening. I mean, you don't see people eating entire pizzas by themselves. We even cut the footlongs in half into two regular size sandwiches before handing them to you. But I guess that wasn't clear enough.
This is the Onion News Network.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com. The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the liberty media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You can bring up what you'd like. Just dial in toll-free. The latest on the, not the Silk Road this time, but Evolution Marketplace. What was the world's most popular underground market is now offline. And we're going to get into that here.
Sort of the downside of being popular underground.
Well, it's true. And although it could also be that they were, you know, always intending to take it down as well. But if you want to get yourself some Bitcoin, now might be a good time. The market, the price of Bitcoin has dropped essentially since Evolution Marketplace went down, and it's now at around $250 per Bitcoin, which of course you can get fractions of a Bitcoin. You can get up to $40 worth of Bitcoin for no fee whatsoever over at ExpressCoin.com by using coupon code FTL. So again, ExpressCoin.com, you can also get Litecoin and Dogecoin there. They are a licensed money services business. It's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. Get your cryptocurrencies with money order, check, or wire transfer. Just go to ExpressCoin.com. Whether you're in the U.S. or Canada, you can also do it from your smartphone, ExpressCoin.com. They've got an app. Go and grab that. Coupon code FTL, again, gets you up to $40 worth of your preferred cryptocurrency with no fee at all. So ExpressCoin.com, coupon code FTL. The price of Bitcoin dropped pretty precipitously. Like, it was getting up real close to $300 per Bitcoin, and then looks like within the last 24 hours has dropped off down to about $250. The story from Wired.com's Andy Greenberg, who is their security writer, one of their security writers. He's been covering the Silk Road for a number of years, so he's fairly intimately familiar with the underground black marketplaces. For those that don't know, Chris Cantwell, would you like to describe what an underground marketplace is on Tor, and what is Tor?
Well, Tor is an anonymization network that it basically bounces your internet traffic between a number of sources and encrypts it in order to prevent people from finding out who you are. And this is something that there's been some holes poked in it over a period of time, and nobody's entirely sure just how secure the network is. But for most of us, it should be secure enough. What happens is, unfortunately, when you run a service on that, that it stays there and it does not, it needs to be able to be found. It apparently, there's some downside to that, that people can figure out who you are. And this seems to be what has happened over there with Evolution, has happened with Silk Road. And
well, we don't know why Evolution has gone offline, but it's certainly what happened with Silk Road, where they went after the creator, the alleged creator, now found guilty, creator of Silk Road, Ross Ulbricht. The Silk Road was the first and therefore the most infamous of these marketplaces. There was a Silk Road 2.0, which lasted for about a year after Silk Road, the original Silk Road, got taken down. They busted Silk Road 2.0. There's now a third Silk Road that is currently in operation, but the third Silk Road didn't get the foothold that the first and the second ones did. I think the second Silk Road, people wanted to believe that this was still a good site, even though it turned out from the federal indictment that there was a federal agent who was an administrator of Silk Road 2.0 from the beginning, the same guy who worked his way into an administrator role of Silk Road 1.0. So the whole Silk Road 2.0 thing was completely botched from the word go.
Well, that's kind of the thing about having an anonymous network. I mean, the idea being, the way you're building your reputation is basically by doing a bunch of illegal things, and it's not as if the federal government is exactly above breaking its own laws in order to catch people defying the edicts of its masters. And
yeah, they had to sell drugs in order to get to the point where they could be an administrator of the Silk Road.
Right, which is not something that the federal government is exactly averse to doing. I've remarked just about the Postal Service itself. It seems to be the one thing that the government does better than the free market is deliver drugs. You can't ship drugs through FedEx or UPS. You do it through the Postal Service. They obviously have immunity to do such things, and so they're not nearly as averse to doing it as your average private person is. And so if you are going to be if you want to go and get involved with these people, well, the way you're building your reputation is basically by doing these things that normal people suffer the risk of imprisonment for doing, and government. Governments are obviously don't have the same aversion to that as the rest of us. So they manage to, it's easier for them to infiltrate than your average like drug ring down on the street, which often gets infiltrated itself.
Yeah, that's true.
But it's not like you're face to face with people. You see all their twitches and their tells, and you can figure out if these people are uncomfortable or lying or whatever. Yeah. And it seems to me that they're almost easier to infiltrate than your in-person drug rings.
So Evolution Market was the top market after the exodus of Silk Road 2.0, after that got taken down. And actually, I believe it was Agro Marketplace was number one, and I think Silk Road 2.0 was number two, and Evolution was number three, and then Evolution overtook Agro Marketplace. I haven't checked Agro Marketplace, but I suspect it's still online. I'll report back to you and post the link on our Facebook, Google Plus, and Twitter. But Evolution has been taken offline at this point.
By the feds?
No. Well, that's not clear, right? Because normally when a site goes down by federal involvement, they splash up their gang signs,
gotcha.
Right?
Gotcha. Like, we got you, Mamba Jamma. Right. You can't bring drugs up in our house. We got you.
That's what that is, right? They're gang signs, gang symbols, the Department of Homeland Security, Europol, these international drug busting kind of organizations. And that apparently hasn't happened with Evolution. I've yet to actually have a chance to pull up the old URL, the what they call a .onion in the world of Tor, this anonymizing system you were talking
about. Your TLD on Tor is .onion.
You can't go to a .onion site through your regular web browser. You have to use the special Tor browser, essentially, to get to these sites.
Right.
And let me give you the story here from Wired Magazine's Andy Greenberg. In the 18 months since the Silk Road online black market for narcotics was taken down by a swarm of three-letter agencies, a site known as Evolution has taken its place at the top of the dark web drug trade. Now Evolution 2 has suddenly dropped off the face of the internet. But unlike its Silk Road predecessor, there's no indication that law enforcement took down the newer black market. Instead, it simply mysteriously vanished, with rumors swirling that its own administrators may have run off with many millions of dollars of its users' drug money.
That's got to be very difficult, right? Like, so, you know, you want people to set up a business where you can sort of do business. And at the same time, since it's in the black market, you've got to trust probably some shady characters. And many of these characters say to themselves, you know, I could do a good service for people over the course of years and probably make a lot of money for myself. Or I can just steal this money, remain anonymous, and go live in a South American country like a king for the rest of my life.
Yeah, I mean, you could either run this thing through till the end when you become the next Ross Ulbricht, or you could walk away with millions of dollars right. in anonymous cryptocurrency and call it a day.
So if one of these marketplaces is going to set up like eBay, right? So eBay doesn't hold your money. When eBay started, I can tell you this. They didn't have PayPal back then. Basically, you decided how you were going to pay. They would expedite it sometimes with credit cards, but essentially money order, check, whatever it was that you wanted to do. You could even go pick it up back then, and they never touched money. They just charged a fee. So at some point, somebody's going to set up an online drug marketplace that is essentially like that, and the rating systems will be how the rating systems are, and they won't be escrowing money. It's the escrowing money that apparently is throwing these things into a tailspin. It makes them too big of a target. They're basically like giant banks on the internet.
You know, it's interesting. So let's talk a little bit about the escrowing factor here, because that's important to explain. When Silk Road 1.0 was out there, they created this where the idea was the buyer would place an order. They would then escrow the Bitcoins with the Silk Road website. So you upload, you know, essentially you fund the Bitcoins into the wallet on the website, and then placing the order then sucks the Bitcoins out of your wallet and into their system. And it was already in their system, and that they were in control of the wallet, period. So even the money that wasn't in escrow, whatever money that the customers might have had sitting in their Silk Road, or in this case, the Evolution Wallets system, all got taken by the administrators of the site. And so the idea was, with Silk Road 2.0, they actually got rid of the escrow system. So that way people would actually have to pay... sort of trust the sellers more, essentially, because the concern was, if money was in escrow, that it was a target for hacking and things like that, as you pointed out. Mm. More coming up here on What Happened with the Evolution Marketplace. It's gone. Free Talk Live.
Hey, it's Mark of Free Talk Live, and I want to tell you about a new way to be prepared for emergencies. Not just big emergencies, but little ones too. It's a source of backup power, so small that I can put it in my pocket or the glove box of my car, but it's so powerful that it can actually jumpstart a bus if I need it to. Sounds crazy, but it's not. I'm talking about a breakthrough in portable power technology called the Pocket Power Plus. If you get stranded in an airport, in your car, or you just want to go off the grid for a while, the Pocket Power Plus becomes your own personal mini power plant. Run pretty much any kind of electronic device for hours, even days if you need to. The Pocket Power Plus can also deliver an enormous supply of on-demand power that can jumpstart almost any vehicle, even the coldest winter days. Comes with free jumper cables and an accessory pack. Best part, my listeners can now get Pocket Power Plus for half price by going to PocketPowerPlus9.com. That's PocketPowerPlus9.com. Use coupon code FTL to save even more. Go to PocketPowerPlus9.com, PocketPowerPlus9.com, coupon code FTL.
If the IRS has garnished your paycheck or seized money from your bank account, you need to get professional tax help now. Fast action is required to put a halt to these aggressive IRS collection tactics. You can count on the knowledgeable team of tax professionals at Wall & Associates. With over 30 years of experience, Wall & Associates has settled the tax problems of thousands of taxpayers for a small fraction of what they owed. For a free face-to-face consultation, call 1-800-425-4610 to put a wall between you and the IRS. 1-800-425-4610, or look for us on the web at wallandassociates.net. We solve tax problems. If you hire Wall & Associates today, you'll never have to talk to the IRS again. To stop the levies and seizures today, take action now. Call Wall & Associates at 1-800-425-4610. Wall & Associates, 1-800-425-4610. Based on actual cases, results may vary. Not a solicitation for legal services.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the road to freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com. Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live, and of course you can bring up anything that you'd like at 855-450-FREE. We're talking about the black market online, Tor, the anonymizing system that is somewhat infamous out there. It's one of the most popular of the anonymizing systems. There are others. There's, let's see, I2P, which has just recently had the Silk Road move to, or I guess also exist on I2P. So there's now a Silk Road Underground Market on Tor, and there's now a Silk Road Underground Market on this newer system, or this less popular system that's supposedly more private. This I2P system. Again, I'm not a programmer. I haven't audited any of this code.
Yeah, my understanding of it, as I've read, and I don't understand it any better than you do, most likely, is that the I2P network is supposedly more anonymous than Tor, and I don't believe that I2P was created by the NSA, which is
that can help.
You know, so it's one of these things that there's perhaps a certain greater level of trust involved in I2P. However, it just hasn't caught on quite as much. So that these people are trying to set up these marketplaces sort of prefer to be on Tor because that's where the market is.
So we got a lot more to say, I think, on this issue because we barely have really even started to talk about what happened with the Evolution Marketplace, the world's most popular underground black market, which also, by the way, sold weapons at Evolution. That was something that Silk Road wouldn't do. The Silk Road did have, for a short time, a separate website called The Armory, which was never very popular. Hardly anyone sold anything there, and ultimately they ended up shutting it down. But there were a few things that you couldn't sell on Silk Road that you can sell, or you could, on Evolution. Now that site's down, and a lot of people are asking the question of what happened to it. We do know the price of Bitcoin has dropped since Evolution Marketplace went offline, and we can talk more about that here in moments. Plus, if you want to talk a lot more about Bitcoin, then you should be at the second annual Texas Bitcoin Conference. It's happening at the Moody Theater in downtown Austin, March 28th and 29th. Mark, you and I were there last year, not at the Moody Theater, but at the Texas Bitcoin Conference. It was at a different location.
Yeah.
It was a great event, and the second one is going to be even better. I mean, the first time you run a conference, you learn what to do right the next time, and you make the second one even better. So Texas Bitcoin Conference. Lots of great speakers. Anthony DiOrio, Charlie Shrem, who is now advertising himself as the first Bitcoin felon. He'll be checking into federal prison shortly after this particular event. Jason King, David Johnston, Sambala Nair, and George Gilder, as well as many others. Go to TexasBitcoinConference.com. Mark, are they going to have you doing emceeing this year?
I will if they want it, but so far no one's said anything to me, but that doesn't mean that I won't be doing it.
Well, at the very least, we're going to be there throughout the entire thing, and we'll be broadcasting live. You can get a $25 discount on their already affordable $150 admission price, so just use code FTL to get the discount at TexasBitcoinConference.com. It's a great event. I'm looking forward to it, and it's coming up here in 10 days. So not too late to go to TexasBitcoinConference.com, use code FTL, get that $25 discount. We will look forward to seeing you March 28th and 29th in downtown Austin, Texas for the second annual Texas Bitcoin Conference.
Way to make your place in history, Charlie Shrem. I'm the first Bitcoin felon. It's just such great marketing when you try, you know, clouds and silver linings and whatnot.
Hey, good for him, man. I mean,
if you go to South by Southwest, the Texas Bitcoin Conference is it's right at the same time.
So right around the corner. Yeah, so there's more to say here on this topic. Silk Road's competitor, Evolution, now offline.
I wanted to point out, this Evolution was doing escrowing. And
that's correct.
At this point, it's not clear if they've been taken down by some government or if they just took the money and ran.
It's almost certain that it's not a government because they would put their splash page up.
Every government would do that, just the United States government.
No, actually, the splash pages are usually multiple governments from around the world. It almost always has Europol on it, too.
Okay.
So this is an international investigation in many cases to bust these websites. They're working in tandem with law enforcement all across the world.
Yeah, I mean, it would almost be like it almost looks like a false flag attack if you don't see the badges on the screen, right? And like after 9/11, they were like, it was Al-Qaeda. And people are like, well, Al-Qaeda always takes credit for these things. Why didn't they? And
all these questions.
So we were talking about escrow.
Right. So
if I were the administrators of that site, that would be the first thing that I would do is just go put the badges up there and be like, this site has been seized.
That wouldn't have been a bad idea. Yeah.
So this escrow seems to be the real problem here, and the major sites.
Well, not necessarily.
It's not necessarily the problem.
No. Escrow was hit previously on the Silk Road. I forget if it was 2.0. Maybe it happened on 1.0 as well. But at one point during Silk Road 2.0, their escrow system got hit. And what I mean by that is whenever somebody bought something, the Bitcoin for that sale would go into escrow on the site. The site then holds that until the drugs or fake IDs or whatever it is the person was buying, until that was delivered. When the buyer then indicates, I got the product, then that releases the Bitcoins from escrow into the seller's account. But the buyer's and seller's accounts are also hosted by the underground site. So ultimately, if the entire site goes down, whether or not they have escrow is really not a factor, because as long as there was money in those wallets, and there was, you know, if you go to the Evolution Reddit right now, you can read some people's stories about how much money they allegedly had in their accounts on this site. The site goes down, the administrator has all the private keys to those accounts, and they can clean them all out.
Well, if the admins have the private keys, if they're maintaining control over the wallets, I mean, it is essentially an escrow service either way. At the end of the day, whether they call it escrow or not, if they're in control of the transfer of the funds, then it's an escrow service.
Well, it's not technically escrow from the buyer's and seller's perspective if they're not running escrow. It's just that the money's sitting on their server, essentially, or the keys are sitting on the server, and there's nothing you can do about it as a customer. You just have to understand this is the price you pay to be on anonymous black markets.
But that is an escrow service. So like if we set up a black market site right now, right, and I said, okay, you buy mushrooms from me, you send from your wallet, you send bitcoins to the public key of the seller, right? Now you're bypassing the middleman. There's no escrow service.
If
the private keys are held by the marketplace, it's essentially an escrow service, even if they're not calling it one. They're holding the funds, and they're, by whatever method, deciding whether or not you actually get to take control of these bitcoins under your private key.
It's a stretch to call that escrow. I mean, it's certainly you're releasing your funds to that site, and they will do as they please with it. Escrow is generally, you don't release the funds, or the funds are not released until the product arrives. And so Silk Road 2.0 did not even have that after their escrow got raided. Essentially, the money that they had for escrow was put into the same wallet. And so there was this really...
That sounds like a bad idea.
Yeah, there was this hot wallet, which had all kinds of Bitcoin coming in and out of it at all times. And whatever security breach was, who knows who created it, there was this breach and somebody got in there and cleaned out that account. Now, what was really unique about Silk Road 2.0 was that they actually paid their customers back.
Right.
They, you know, this was unprecedented in the history of black markets on the internet. You know, everybody figured, oh, great, the administrators just raided their own escrow wallet and, you know, this is all a scam. And to prove that they had really been hacked, essentially, the administrators said, look, we're committed to taking the fees from this site and dedicating them all to paying back the customers who'd lost money in this escrow raid. But after that, they got rid of escrow. And then what would have had to have happened for someone to buy something on the site, you would just have to pay the seller. And you have to trust that the seller's good, which means that sellers could then – people posing as sellers could then take advantage of buyers as well. So the escrow system did a good job at protecting buyers, but ultimately, you know, whether or not the different sites use it or not, most of them still do.
Well, Bitcoin has, as I understand it, a sort of a three-party feature, a
multi-sig. Evolution had offered the multi-sig.
So let me ask you this. Why don't they move to the multi-sig? Because essentially with the multi-sig, let me try to explain as best I can. And I'm probably the least qualified person here to do it, but I'll do my best.
I've never actually done a multi-sig transaction.
So a multi-sig would basically, for instance, you could have a transaction where you know, basically two people have to sign off on the transaction for it to take place. So I could send Bitcoins to you, Ian, but only after Cantwell, who uses his, you know, his portion of the multi-sig says, okay. And therefore you send me the drugs that I want to have. And Cantwell says, and then I report to Cantwell, I got the drugs. And then Cantwell says, okay, and he sends the money to you. Or,
but how's that different from standard escrow?
Because I don't hold the bitcoins, is what
right.
It sounds like.
Cantwell can't run, take the money and run.
But isn't it all just an illusion?
And by the way,
anyway,
he just said he would.
If all of the private, keys are held by the site, then what's the point of multisig anyway?
That's not
right?
a private.
It's just an illusion.
Right. That's not the site holding the private keys, is my understanding of it. Now,
no, it's another public key to a three-person operation.
All right. I don't understand how it would work in the context of this drug market because you don't have the private keys to these wallets. You know, when you go to these underground marketplaces and you create a wallet there, you don't get the private key to that wallet.
Okay. Well, this would be something different. This would be a transaction where I send from my, you know, wallet that a multi-sig transaction where I then Cantwell gets a sort of a key to it, and when he turns his key, then you get the money because the money goes to you, but only after Cantwell says okay.
Yeah, I guess I'd have to see an example of how that would work on an underground marketplace and what benefit it would provide.
I'm Googling multi-sig right now. I've never heard of this.
There's
before.
More coming up here in moments. You can share your thoughts here on Free Talk Live.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom, and with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
Shiny badges on your jacket. Shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write worms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
How many lawyers does it take to change a light bulb? None. They'd rather keep their clients in the dark. There are too many lawyer jokes to count. However, there are some lawyers with more noble intentions. At the Institute for Justice, we bring the light to our clients. We are a nonprofit public interest law firm with clear values and principles. At IJ, we fight for those whose most basic rights are denied by the government. Visit our website today at ij.org.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.50 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,148 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $274. Antiwar.com reports with Ukraine ceasefire continuing to hold well, the Kyiv parliament has yesterday moved forward with a bill on regional autonomy for the east, which was supposed to be the resolution of the conflict. Right now, it's not clear the language satisfies anyone, with Western Ukrainian hawks complaining the bill offers too much autonomy, and Russia complaining some of the terms are in violation of the Minsk ceasefire. The bill does grant autonomy to the breakaway Donbas regions and would allow them to restore Russian as an official language within their territories, a key demand. There are conditions, however. The bill conditions the autonomy on holding a new round of elections to appoint regional officials and seems designed to prevent the current rebel leaders from taking part. The bill says the elections have to be held under Ukrainian control and would annul the elections that the region held just back in November, which put the current rebel leadership in control. For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports the Republican-controlled House of Representatives introduced a budget on Tuesday that seeks to repeal the Affordable Care Act, maintain sequestration, and increase defense spending. House Budget Committee Chairman Tom Price from Georgia unveiled his $3.8 trillion budget that would repeal the Affordable Care Act in its entirety. A Medicare voucher-like premium support model for seniors would begin in 2024, where beneficiaries would receive subsidies to purchase health insurance on the private market. According to Republican leadership, the plans would balance the federal budget by cutting $5.5 trillion in spending over the next 10 years. The budget would maintain sequestration or automated spending limits on domestic and defense spending, but would indirectly increase defense spending by using war funds to get around current budget caps. The Budget Control Act, written by Congress, exempts overseas contingencies operations from spending limits. Chairman Tom Price said in a statement, "It is a plan that balances the budget in less than 10 years, secures and strengthens vital programs like Medicare, provides our military men and women with the resources they need to protect American families, and would make Washington more efficient, effective, and accountable to hardworking taxpayers." The Republican House budget would increase President Obama's $58 billion proposal for overseas contingencies to $94 billion. Total defense spending in the Republican budget proposal would be $613 billion, $52 billion higher than Obama's proposed $561 billion. The budget could lose support in the Senate, where several Republicans, including Senator John McCain, said they will not support a budget that keeps sequestration cuts. ExpressCoin is the best choice for buying Bitcoin, Litecoin, Dogecoin, and more. Get your cryptocurrencies with money order, check, wire transfer, or cash deposit. Get started at expresscoin.fppradio.com. Reuters reports a San Diego judge has dismissed gang conspiracy charges against a rapper whose music prosecutors said encouraged gun violence against rival gangs in a ruling his lawyer characterized as a victory for free speech. Rapper Brandon Duncan, who uses the stage name Tiny Do, was one of seven people charged last June in a 16-count indictment that centered on nine shootings that took place in 2013 and 2014 involving the so-called Linkin Park gang. Duncan was charged with nine counts of conspiracy to participate in a criminal street gang by prosecutors who said his music and social media presence encouraged the violence, although he was not accused of taking part in any of the shootings. On Monday afternoon, San Diego Superior Court Judge Luis Hinoyan threw out charges against Duncan and defendant Aaron Harvey, ruling that there is no evidence that the two defendants participated in the crimes or benefited from them. Brian Watkins, who represented Duncan, said,
This is a First Amendment victory. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Following morning reports indicating that Philadelphia High School for the Performing Arts student Samantha Bylum deals with really weird social pressures on a daily basis, Onion reporters met with the 16-year-old dance student who described feeling regularly alienated from her peers for extremely bizarre reasons.
If you're not up to date on the latest urban street art or Esperanza Spalding albums, the other students will eat you alive. It can get pretty brutal. Just the other day, everyone cut class to go watch the Million Dollar Quartet musical at the Forest Theater, but nobody told me. Now I'm the only one that hasn't seen Lance Guest's rendition of Folsom Prison Blues. It's humiliating.
According to Bylum, the school year shows no sign of letting up as she continues dealing with the everyday stresses of auditioning for the school's production of My Fair Lady, keeping up with the latest punk Afrofusion dance groups, and not having enough fishnet sleeves to wear throughout the week.
Honestly, I don't know how the other students deal with it.
Keep checking theonion.com for more as this story develops.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll-free here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. You can join us online over at freetalklive.com. We've been talking about the black market, and there's yet another loss to the underground world of drug and fake ID sales, as well as other things, hacking tools, weapons, a variety of interesting products were available for sale at first the Silk Road. Then, after Silk Road 1.0 was taken down, several other marketplaces sprung up, and then one of them was called Evolution. Now, Evolution didn't really take off until the takedown of the second Silk Road, at least from the numbers that I had seen. It had actually been doing very well when Silk Road 2.0 was around, but Silk Road 2.0 had beaten it out. And once Silk Road 2.0 was gone, then Evolution took the top spot from Agro Marketplace. Now, Agro Marketplace is supposedly still online. However, when I attempted to access it a moment ago, I was unable to do so, likely because they're getting slammed with customers as a result of Evolution going offline within the last, apparently within the last 24 hours or so. We were talking about the escrow systems on these websites and how people have lost Bitcoins by using the escrow systems, but more people have lost Bitcoin simply by using these black markets. And that's really what the issue is. I did finally find an article here that explains how multisig works on a different one of these various different drug underground marketplaces. I don't want to really read it here because it may be a little too technical, I think, for air. And
yeah, it's boring.
The attempted explanation was difficult enough when you were, Mark, just trying to explain how multisig worked in general. And I think that kind of made sense, like, you know, the sort of the two people at the bank vault turning keys at the same time. Sort of there's the digital equivalent of that with Bitcoins. Would that be a short way of explaining
it? I think that's a sufficient explanation of it for the air. I mean, I was sort of reading about the nuts and bolts of it myself during the break there. And I mean, it's not very good talk radio to discuss, but it is. That's basically the idea of it, that it's like, hey, turn your key. Okay, I turn my key, and then you turn your key when you confirm the transaction. And the payment is not released until it's confirmed.
So, but the big loss that people have taken from these sites being taken down is the money that they have been in their just regular wallets. Because in order to purchase products or services on these black market websites, the black market site requires you to have Bitcoin in their wallet system. So you get a Bitcoin address, and you can send Bitcoins to that address from anywhere on the internet.
You get a public key that you can fund Bitcoins into. You don't have the private key, so you do not actually control the spending of the Bitcoins.
Correct. I mean, you can control the spending through the site, but if the site goes down, your Bitcoins are gone.
Yeah.
And that's what's happened here with the Evolution site, is they just disappeared. And by all indication, it's not the government who took them down. So the story's from Wired.com. Andy Greenberg saying here that some believe the administrators of Evolution have run off with millions of dollars of its users' drug money. Over the past weekend, the massive anonymous market known as Evolution halted withdrawals of Bitcoin from its website, telling users it was dealing with technical difficulties. Then on Tuesday evening, both its market and user forum went offline, with no opportunity for drug buyers and sellers to pull out the funds that they had stored in their Evolution accounts. The result has been a wave of panic that's shaken the online black market economy as much as any of the law enforcement drug busts of the last 2 years. Late Tuesday, a Reddit user named NSW Great, who had earlier self-described as an Evolution drug dealer and public relations staffer, he or she had even hosted an Ask Me Anything session about the job days earlier, wrote a post to Reddit's Darknet Markets forum that claimed to confirm Evolution's administrators had, in fact, shut down the site's back end too and escaped with users' money. The NSW Great user described confronting the Evolution's two pseudonymous owners, Verto and Kimball, who he or she says then admitted they were closing the market and stealing the funds. Quote, "I'm so sorry, but Verto and Kimball have effed us all. I have over $20,000 in escrow myself from sales," he wrote, or she, who knows. "I'm sorry for everyone's losses. I'm gutted and speechless. I feel so betrayed." Now, of course, you're taking his word for it, right? And all of these people, you don't know who they actually are. Who's Verto and Kimball? No one knows, which is why it's so easy to just cut and run from these websites. And there are, of course, you know, in the black market, there can be situations where cutting and running is the best thing you can do to preserve your own freedom, right? Because if, let's say, law enforcement is on your tail and you catch wind through somebody that's, you know, lets you know that there's an investigation being run, you shut down operations and you, you know, either lay low or get the hell out of town, or in this case, get out of the country if you're in the United States.
And well, and in these, in the cases of these marketplaces, you can be certain that there's some kind of investigation going on.
Constantly.
How close that investigation is getting to the actual people who run the market, that's another question. But they know that without any question that they, if they are the number one online drug marketplace, there's no question as to whether or not they're being investigated.
Right, and they can't stay on top forever, and the, you know, just by nature of the black market, drug dealers come and they go, right? Like, some of them stay around for longer than others. Some of them stop. They get out because they get busted. Others get out because the heat gets too high. And so who knows? Maybe this guy's BSing and he just wants to make himself look good because he's going to start up his own site after this. I mean, who knows what actually happened behind the scenes?
For all we know, he is this Verto and this other person.
He could very well have done this
and been like, well, now I'm going to set up this thing and blah, 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 blah.
I just so happened to copy the code from the site, guys. Here's my new site. I'm only charging 2%. Come on over. And then this process begins again. He, you know, runs a legitimate, what seems to be a legitimate site for a year or 6 months, gains people's trust, and then shuts that one down. So, I mean, I think that it's a bummer when this stuff happens for the people that have money that are sitting, that, you know, money sitting on the site. Because again, if you want to buy things from the site, you have to have money in that wallet. And, you know, if that money sits there for any period of time, the longer it sits, something's going to happen, right? And so you just sort of, this is the cost of doing business in the black marketplace. And when all things are considered, it's actually a pretty fair cost. I mean, if you look at it from the perspective of, okay, so you just lost some money. If you were at Evolution.
Right. I was going to ask this. What do you think? Is this a net, still a net positive in the world of black markets where people get shot and killed?
Yes. Yes, I think so.
As opposed to the ending scene of Scarface, this sounds like quite the bargain, right?
If you lost $50, or even if you lost $500, it's
better. $20,000 in the case of the seller. At least a hit squad didn't come in and
pump you full of holes while you say,
"Hey, hello to my little friend."
And it's also, remember, these black markets—they're anonymous. So the buyers don't know who the sellers are, and the sellers don't know who the buyers are. So therefore, these buyers, even if they've lost money sitting in these wallets on the sites, at least you didn't buy drugs from some sort of informant. They can't inform on you because they don't know who you are. So there's almost a zero chance that whoever you're dealing with is anything but, you know, somebody who's a legit participant in that black market. I mean, yeah, there's some scammers, so you could get scammed by some of the participants on these marketplaces, but you'll never have a gun put to your head, and you'll never have handcuffs put on you unexpectedly,
unless the deal goes bad.
Unless the government finds you.
I mean, it just happened to Ross Ulbricht, of course, but...
Well, he was the administrator. I meant as the buyer. I'm sorry if I wasn't clear on that. As just somebody going to buy some drugs, your risk is incredibly lower going to these underground marketplaces.
Right. Yeah. And I've told the story before that, you know, when I lived in New York, I had a buddy who was a Brooklyn Gang Unit cop, and him and his pals would they called it the overtime well, that when they found a drug dealer, rather than bust the drug dealer, they'd wait by the drug dealer's drug spot towards the end of their shift and just bust buyers so that they had a steady supply of overtime and that sort of thing. You can't do that with the online drug marketplaces.
So what they would do is they'd let the dealer continue to sell, even though he's harming the community, is the idea, in order to be able to bust the buyers as they come in. You bust a buyer, then it takes 2 hours to do the paperwork, and they get another couple hours of overtime.
Overtime. They call it the overtime well.
And plus pat up the arrest records while you're at it, too. Yeah. And
I'm not going to call that evil, but it's close.
Yeah, and if you're a corrupt cop like that, you might want to confiscate the drugs that those people have on them. Keep it for yourself.
Certainly. His wife was a pothead, and yep. he'd bring home
pot
all the time. Yeah.
Yeah. So more here from the story. And if you want to share your thoughts here, whether or not you've had experience on these underground marketplaces, it's a fascinating concept, fascinating just continuing drama, you know, interesting things happening. This site being shut down, what's the real story? I don't know if we'll ever find out, but there's more to the story here from Wired.com in moments. And it seems like this coincided with the huge drop in Bitcoin price today as well. So this was a pretty important site to the Bitcoin marketplace, apparently. 855-450-FREE is the number. This is Free Talk Live.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
It takes a lot of courage to face your own death, but I'm glad I finally did. See, I was putting off getting life insurance to protect my family, even though I knew it was important. Then my neighbor's husband died. I watched her struggle emotionally and financially. It really made me face reality. If my husband died, how would I pay the mortgage, the car payments, or keep up the life the kids and I had? I realized I needed to get us life insurance right away. So I called AIG Direct. In less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing my family has protection.
Call AIG Direct right now for a free, no-obligation quote. The call takes less than 5 minutes, and you can save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-463-9184. That's 1-800-463-9184. 1-800-463-9184.
Again, the Congressional Budget Office sounds the alarm. This time warns of Greek-style U.S. debt crises. You heard me right. The GAO is drawing a parallel between the U.S. economy, its debt, and the current Greek economic meltdown. With the debt-to-GDP chart climbing into unfamiliar territory, the growing budget deficit will rise to unsupportable levels. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. The Federal Debt and Risk of Financial Crises document the CBO has published is a must-read for every American. Covering the risk of continued deficit spending coupled with an aging population and the rising interest rates spell economic disaster. It's imperative that you get a copy of this document and study it for yourself. Call me today at 800-686-2237, and I'll send you a free copy. Again, call 800-686-2237 and ask for your copy of the CBO document. Once again, you need to read this government report. Call 800-686-2237.
Hey guys, Mark Claire here, LionsOfLiberty.com, where we strive to advance the ideas of liberty daily. We bring you The Morning Roar! That's right, every Monday to Friday we'll have a brand new edition of The Morning Roar, where we provide a roundup of some news stories that you may not find in the mainstream media or even in your typical social media news feed. We find stories that relate to the ideas of liberty and provide you with our liberty perspective on them. Every Monday, we have our longest-running feature, Mondays with Murray, named after the great libertarian Murray Rothbard, where we'll examine an article or an excerpt from his works and help convey his view, along with our little spin as well. We wrap it all up every Friday with Felony Friday, where our own John Odermatt goes out and takes a look at some sort of felony. There's felonies committed every day, you know, whether it's a felony committed by the police, a politician, or even an average citizen. You can find all of this and so much more over at LionsOfLiberty.com. Advancing the ideas of liberty daily.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938, 877-357-9938.
You can watch the LRN Studio Cam and chat with other listeners anytime at cam.lrn.fm. That's cam.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. You dial toll-free if you want to bring up anything that's on your mind at 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. We've been talking privacy to some extent in this conversation about Tor, the anonymizing system on the internet, one of the few systems available, and in the context of talking about these black market sites that have been taken down, usually by governments, but sometimes by the operators themselves to essentially just milk all of their customers and vendors of all the bitcoins that they had sitting in their online wallets, which, by the way, is what happened after Silk Road 1.0. I don't know if you remember this, but when Silk Road 1.0 went down, there were like five new markets that sprung up into existence after that. And one of them was called Sheep Marketplace. Now, if you couldn't tell that one was going to go down beforehand, well, you know, you might have been the right target for that site. But what Sheep Marketplace did was they created a legitimate looking site that had all of the functionality of Silk Road 1.0, and they advertised, hey, you know, we're here, Silk Road users, come on over. And of course they did. Many of the same vendors came over from Silk Road, and the buyers came there as well. But again, there were other markets that were competing. And, you know, Sheep Marketplace ran with that for several months and then shut down. I don't even know if they made it several months. I'm not sure. It didn't seem like it was that long. But then they just shut down. They closed up shop. It wasn't the feds who took them down. They took their own site down so they could take a whole bunch of Bitcoin. So, you know, you've got to protect yourself online. And one of the things you can use for that purpose is ProXPN. It's a great way to encrypt your internet connection so your internet service provider doesn't know what you're doing anymore. They're not logging you anymore. They can't. They can't log what you're doing because you're encrypted. Plus, people that might have been sniffing your Wi-Fi packets, maybe when you're sitting at the coffee shop or at work on your Wi-Fi, you know, your Wi-Fi enabled device, your packets will then be encrypted by ProXPN. So again, it's a great way to protect your privacy online, and you can do it for very affordable price. You get 50% off the price of their annual account by using our discount code FTL50 over at proxpn.com/FTL. That gets you unlimited bandwidth, servers around the world that you can access. You can privately torrent and get past regionally blocked websites. Plus, ProXPN does not keep records of your online habits at all. So just go, start with their app. You can download it for free. Windows, Macintosh, iOS, Android, Linux, whatever you're using, you can probably get ProXPN for it. ProXPN.com/FTL. When you're ready to upgrade to premium, use code FTL50 to get that discount 50% off, and that locks in for the lifetime of the account. So after a year's gone by, you're ready to re-up for another year, you get the same great deal. ProXPN.com/FTL, code FTL50 for a great discount on privacy that is priceless, and there's a risk-free 7-day money-back guarantee. Don't do this to us, Evo staff, please, another user pleaded in a response on Reddit. There's a,
there's nothing left to do except beg.
Yeah. So we're talking about these black market sites. Evolution went down within the last 24 hours or so after the administrators of the site suspiciously locked down withdrawals on the site. And one of the folks who was, I guess, an assistant administrator there is now claiming that he has personally seen the administrators of the site, Verto and Kimball, admitting that they were closing the market and running with the funds. If Evolution's owners, this from Wired.com, did in fact steal their users' funds stored on the site, a theory that's not still confirmed, or still not confirmed, it's
It's not clear just how much they would have profited, but given the size of Evolution's market, with nearly 20,000 drug product listings, as well as thousands more items ranging from weapons to stolen credit cards, the sum could easily be millions or even tens of millions of dollars worth of Bitcoin.
Somebody's estimating $12 million here, you know, by a story.
Comparison, the FBI seized $3.6 million worth of Bitcoin from the original Silk Road at the time of its October 2013 takedown, when the site was still significantly smaller than Evolution. So this site had gotten very, very popular, and for good reason. The site was very, very well put together. One of the problems with the black market sites is that the searches, for instance, would search through the entire site. So whatever you would type in, they'd search. If you were looking for fake IDs, it would show you drug results if, you know, one of the words was the same in the description. Evolution would allow you, kind of like eBay or Amazon, to actually search in a category and a subcategory. And it was fairly fast as well. So the response of Evolution, when you're on Tor, a lot of sites are slow, because it's an anonymizing system and there's a certain number of hops that all the data is going through before it gets to your computer. Things can be slow on Tor.
Yeah, I never actually bought anything from Silk Road, but I did like visit it and sort of explore it a little bit. And sometimes just, you know, you click on something and the page fails to load and then you have F5 the page and, you know, it's a big pain in the neck. But apparently these people managed to keep their thing working pretty smoothly.
Yep. So and also they charged lower amounts to their vendors. So there was a real reason for buyers and sellers to shop there. If the vendors were paying less to list their items, then that price usually got the savings usually got passed along to the customer. And so, you know, given one market versus another with the same vendor doing business on multiple markets, then buyers are going to go where the products are the cheapest. And that was Evolution, at least that I'd seen. Again, I did also create accounts on some of these sites to kind of poke around and see what was going on there. And I know people who have used them successfully, various different ones. For other dark web markets, technical glitches and long downtime would be routine rather than a sign of a major scam. But since it first appeared online just over a year ago, Evolution had developed a reputation for professionalism and reliability. According to the site Darknet Stats, the site had a 97% uptime rate, which, by the way, I'd never heard of Darknet Stats till today. Their website is dnstats.net. They actually monitor all these different Darknet sites to let you know if they're actually online or not, and you know how often they are online and that kind of thing, whether they have different levels of security. So 97% uptime rate, far higher than competing markets like Agora or the now defunct Silk Road 2. The site gained users' trust by offering a feature known as multi-signature transactions, designed to prevent exactly the sort of Bitcoin theft its administrators are now accused of. Mm. That system would require at least two out of three parties in a transaction, the buyer, the seller, and Evolution's administrators, to sign off on a deal. But due to its complexity, buyers rarely use the feature. That relative sophistication, along with the seizure of several smaller competitors in a string of law enforcement busts late last year, contributed to Evolution's rising position over the last year as the go-to online black market. But Evolution also distinguished itself from other markets by its far looser sense of morality. While other websites followed the original Silk Road ethos of selling only victimless contraband, Evolution also trafficked in stolen identity information. Mm. Its founder, known as...
That's bothered me, the idea that these stolen credit cards could be available there. The question is, are people actually harmed, right? So if I take your credit card and I successfully use it, the chances of you being harmed are very slim, but
it's still fraud. I mean,
multinational bank is going to be defrauded.
You're still harming the vendor, for instance.
And
in that case.
You are harming the user at the same time. I mean, identity theft is a huge problem. It causes people a tremendous amount of
credit damage.
Trying to repair this stuff. A lot of people.
There's a lot of time.
Yeah, if you are not necessarily the most a careful person about watching over your finances, you might end up paying for some charge. You know, of course, if somebody gets a stolen credit card number, they'll run it up to the point that you'll usually notice it. But I imagine that there are some people who, could use somebody's credit card number to buy something and they just end up paying the bill.
There's more on the way here in moments. More about the Evolution Markets rise to the top. 855-450-FREE and their disappearance. 855-450-3733. Your comments welcome.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here, and I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, Mark, at freetalklive.com.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101ReasonsFilm.com. 101ReasonsFilm.com.
You're listening to the best liberty-oriented audio streamed around the clock, on the air, and online. This is the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
Free Talk Live. You may dial toll-free here, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Joining you in studio, Ian here.
Cantwell.
And Mark.
We've got a detailed discussion here that's been going on of the takedown of the most recent, most popular black marketplace online. The Evolution Market is now gone. Of course, the black markets are still alive and well. There are many, many more that are out there. There's probably more than a dozen that are active, according to DarkNet Stats, dnstats.net. listing what does appear to be, several of them are still online. So the black market's not going away, and users, while many of them are hurt because they've been taken advantage of, they've been robbed, essentially, is that by all indicators, it's likely that the administrators of this website, Evolution, took the money and they ran. We'll talk more about them here in moments, the site itself, and why it rose to the top, what made it different.
If you want more freedom in your life, check out this project. It's called Fort Galt, and it's at fortgalt.com. What they're doing is they're building this kind of condo building at or a ski resort or that sort of thing. It's, you know, like the building you'd have at a ski resort instead of, say, a vast valley of sprawling estates or something like that. They're doing it in southern Chile, and they're making really small spaces, you know, for people to purchase and have kind of an area outside of the North America if they want, for whatever reason, to leave the country, maybe as a vacation, as a bug out space, or to live there. Whatever it is, you can do that. Also, when you're not using your room, you can rent it out as a hotel room. They'll be doing that too. So I think it's a really interesting project, and you can check them out at fortgalt.com. These accommodations are going to be affordable, and they're only going to be available to about 100 people. So you don't want to wait until the whole place is full. You want to, you know, get your choice now. fortgalt.com. Go check it out. And let's not forget that it's summer in Chile when it's winter in the United States. So there you go. And so Canada.
We're discussing Evolution Market. It was the top of the drug markets. Now, it's interesting. I'm actually looking on the Darknet Stats website, and it actually doesn't show on this site, or maybe I'm just not on the right page. It doesn't show how many listings these sites currently have. That's how Evolution was listed previously as the number one market. They log into all of the sites.
Listings.
Yeah, and they, you know, which one's got the most listings? That's the most popular market. So back to the story here from Wired.com, Evolution's disappearance, talking about the founder of the site, Verto, who had previously run a site known as the Tor Carter Forum, another invite-only dark website devoted exclusively to credit card fraud. Given that criminal mindset, it may be no surprise that the site's owners might have eventually become willing to steal from their own users as well.
Yeah, I hate to tell you folks at home that if you gave your bitcoins to guys who sold stolen credit card numbers, you're a moron and you got what you deserved.
Well, I mean, it's like I said, it's one of the costs of doing business, I think, is that at any time these sites can go down for any reason, whether it's the person cutting and running with the cash or whether it's the feds coming in with a raid. You know, the longer you use these websites and the longer you have money in the site itself, then the more likely you are to get taken.
And there's a certain amount of risk that comes with no matter where you are, don't get me wrong, but I'm telling you right now that if the guy's in the business of selling stolen credit card numbers, that you don't let him hold on to your Bitcoin, stupid.
As one user wrote on Reddit's Darknet Market Forum, quote, "I'm really surprised Evo went out like this, but I mean, from former carters and fraudsters, would you expect anything less?" Unquote.
He's really surprised that the guys who sold stolen credit card numbers went out like this. That's like being like, "I'm really surprised that the government would spy on us after promising to be the most transparent administration in history."
Others pointed out that competing black markets like Agora, which briefly held the top spot as the most popular dark web market before Evolution, will likely absorb the refugees from Evolution's vanished market. But even so, the Evolution staffers' theft of millions of dollars from their users, if it's confirmed, would put a temporary but serious dent in the internet's underground drug economy. Quote, one user on Reddit writes, "I'm guessing Evolution's owners have new identities and a nice remote beachside mansion all lined up. Probably there already. Damn.
Down there at Fort Galt living it up."
Sounds like a movie, except real people lost real money. So there you go.
I'd be interesting to see, and I wish Mr. Greenberg had checked. I mean, if we've got the public key for where you're putting your bitcoins for them to hold them, then we should be able to see if the bitcoins are transferred to other wallets.
Yeah. That you can do. I mean, that's one of the things that's happened when some sites in the past have been taken down is, you know, sort of Bitcoin forensic analysts have jumped in to try to, trace where these bitcoins went to and to which wallet they ended up in, and then, you know, watched that wallet essentially. Oh, this wallet's got 30,000 bitcoins in it. Let's keep an eye on it and see what happens with those bitcoins. Will the person, you know, mess up and buy something in the legitimate market from that wallet, making it maybe possible to trace who that person is?
Well, and what's important to point out here is this wouldn't be the first time that a hit's been put out on somebody because of Bitcoin. They have this assassination marketplace or whatever.
It's another Tor site.
Yeah, another Tor site out there that, you know, you can sell drugs anonymously on the internet. You could also buy hits anonymously on the internet. And
I haven't heard of any of these things actually like coming to fruition. I've seen the anonymous. They had Ben Bernanke up there, on the, and I thought that was great. And then Janet Yellen came in, and there's a hit out on Janet Yellen. But you know, do we hear about people actually collecting the bounties on these things? And I don't believe that I've heard that headline yet.
No, well, the bounties. You know, obviously they grow. People put. You know, they pool their money, and the idea is if a person can pick the day that this individual dies,
they get the payout.
It's like a Deadpool,
right.
And the only person that really can pick somebody's day that they're murdered is the person who's going to murder them, and so that's kind of interesting.
Oh wait, so if you predict the day of their death, then
you get the cash,
get the money,
you get the Bitcoin.
Yeah,
it's interesting.
So that's interesting.
It's an anonymous Deadpool, essentially, is what it is.
Hmm. So, you know, we haven't seen anybody go down yet, but at the same time, a lot of these are just kind of, you know, I wouldn't take it, if I were Ben Bernanke, I wouldn't take it as a joke, but I mean, I guess I just don't take it seriously that somebody's actually going to assassinate Ben Bernanke.
Well, I take it deadly seriously. I would like for the Fed chair to have some concern for their safety. Let me just put it that way.
I'll have to pull up Assassination Market and see who's on the current list, because I think it's probably been about a year or so since we've talked about that here on Free Talk Live. We'll do that here in a moment. You're welcome to share your thoughts on the takedown of Evolution Market and the black markets online in general. I still think they're heroic efforts. I realize some of them are going to turn out to be scams. Agro Marketplace has been going strong for quite a long time, and of course, they use the word agro, which suggests that there are probably libertarians who are behind that that particular website. I mean, we know Ross Ulbricht certainly was the operator of the Silk Road. I suspect the same thing's true of whoever it is that's behind Agro Marketplace. So, you know, share your thoughts here with us, and I'll see if I can get on Agro and verify that it's actually up and running here tonight, because I imagine they're swamped. If there are servers online at all, it's probably getting hit pretty heavily with users jonesing for their next hit. So let's go to Fred in Ohio first, though. Fred, you're on Free Talk Live.
Yo, guys.
Hey, you're on the air.
Cool. Okay, so first I'm going to harken back to the past couple days with the robot stuff you guys are talking about.
Yes, sir.
Have you seen this page? I actually heard about it from Tom Wood's show. It's called Robots for a $15 Minimum Wage.
I have not.
No, it sounds like a joke.
I know, it does, doesn't it? I think it is. But they all their posts, they seem like liberal, Democrat, kind of like dead serious. So it's hard to tell. I mean, it's really ironic.
I actually have a couple of spoof sites on the internet, right, where I speak as though I am the opposition, and there are some people.
Stopfreeking.info.
Stopfreeking.info, AntonioBuehler.org. Here's a couple of them, and so there are people who are frequently confused as to whether or not the site is serious or not, because I do sort of put things in similar terms to the way these people often talk. I just sort of blow it out of proportion. Well, I think this is similar.
Robots for the $15 minimum wage seems obvious. It's obvious satire. Yeah. Hang on. We'll bring you back, talk more about it here in a moment. Fred, 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number, 855-450-3733. This is Free Talk Live.
His hair was falling out in clumps.
Petey stopped eating and all his hair fell out.
Mounds and mounds of fur all over the place.
Our hairballs have hairballs.
Our golden retriever, Sundance, scratched incessantly. There was hair all over. I heard a radio advertisement for Dynavite.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
The omega-3 fatty acids, zinc.
There's flaxseed oil, the seaweed, the kelp,
the digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
Within 2 weeks. 2 weeks. The shedding slowed down to almost none. The scratching went away after a few days, and Sundance's coat was starting to get shiny and glossy the way it had when she was a puppy.
Tons of energy, no more bad smells.
If your dog has shedding, dry skin, excessive scratching, the phone number for Dynavite is 859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
So who else will you meet at the Get Prepared Expo? For starters, from Republic Broadcasting, John Moore and John Stadtmiller. From GCN, Aaron and Brad Dakins, Joyce Riley, and me, Vincent Finelli. Joining us are the instructors whom you've learned to trust. Surgeon of the Year, Dr. Norman Shuley. Engineer, Matt Stein. The real Fox Mulder of the X-Files, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Author and analyst, Captain John Reagan. Your counter-terrorist from Central America, Mike Ma. Dental center owner and my dentist, Dr. Howard Shane. Radiation instructor, Craig Douglas. Author and survivalist, Rich Sheban. Author, Judy Dollarhite. Cancer center owner from Mexico, Dr. Patrick Vickers. Bug out expert and pilot, Captain Bill Sermo. Beekeeper, Jeff Maddox. Seedsman, Mike Knox. Author, Gayla Pruitt. Author, Harry Cooper. Food expert, Joe Acapinti. And Bill Whaley, the junk man. March 27, 28, and 29. GetPreparedExpo.com, the largest preparedness and survival expo in the USA.
Because we are smothering in spam, please do not reply to all when you can instead reply. I was recently among over 100 invited to a corporate reunion. It's always a warm affair, and that's the problem. Enthusiasm for our upcoming get-together caused many recipients to RSVP the organizer with a cheery reply to all. I can't wait. Then others piled on with a reply to all to that. Then the I'm out of my office now autoresponders joined in. So I replied to all, asking that we all reply only to the organizer. Hey, at least I tried. One invitee, apparently retired, shot back, point taken, but I really like seeing the responses since they're so positive. Smiley face. This better be an open bar. From SurvivalSpeech.com, I'm Holland Cook.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
If there was a place liberty-minded people had been elected to political positions and were rolling back government, would you move there? If freedom lovers had secured a 20% voting block and can veto most bad bills, would you move? Well, the time has come to sign the pledge at freestateproject.org. These things have happened in New Hampshire, and you can join us and help. freestateproject.org. Sign up now at freestateproject.org.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. You dial toll-free to bring up whatever you'd like. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. You can join us online over at freetalklive.com. Enjoy the features that we have waiting for you there. We've been talking a lot about online black marketplaces, and there's a little bit more to say about that. I actually was able to get to the Agora marketplace, so they still are online and likely are currently the world's number one market now that Evolution has been taken offline. If you've always wanted to check one of these places out, I'll give you the link on our social bookmarking here, Facebook, Google Plus, Twitter. You can follow us in whatever way is best for you. Just go to news.freetalklive.com to hook up with us on your favorite social bookmarking website. That's news.freetalklive.com. Let's go back to Fred, listening in Ohio. So, Fred, you were saying Tom Woods had linked to some sort of a website that was something about robots for the minimum wage or robots to increase the minimum wage for $15 to $15. Is that right?
Yeah, it was actually just like a Facebook community, I think is what it would be referred to.
Yeah, I mean, that's obviously a joke. And the reason why is because, well, the idea is that, well, as the minimum wage goes up, that more automation and more robot technology will replace jobs. So that would be the joke there.
Oh, like, yeah.
The robots want that to happen.
No, yeah, I understand that. And I'm sure, yeah. I know Tom Woods understood that as well. But I don't know if they actually do, which is kind of. Kind of hilarious.
Well, lefties would want the minimum wage to go up so it can help people, not robots. So it doesn't seem like
a
lefty thing.
On the website, they're saying, like, you know, raise the wage for our human brethren. We need a living wage and all this stuff. And they're, like, part of SEIU. They're supporting all that stuff. So I was kind of, I mean, it's hard to understand whether they're serious or not.
Well, they're obvious. Why do you mean it's hard to tell if they're serious? It's robots for a $15 an hour minimum wage. It's obviously, you're actually having trouble telling if, if this is a joke?
It's hard to tell.
Now that you say that.
I assumed it was. I mean, but when
because I'm sure that Tom Woods is tweeting out all sorts of pro minimum wage propaganda.
No, I think he just found it as hilarious as I did.
There you go.
I had one more thing to say here before I go. So I was just kind of musing over dinner about this idea I had for like Robin Hooding. You know,
Robin Hooding is putting change in expired meters to save people from getting parking tickets, preferably. Right before the meter maid reaches the expired meter. That goes on here and there in Keene, New Hampshire, where we are. Just wanted to explain what Robin Hooding was. Go ahead with your idea.
Yeah, thank you. So I had kind of an idea for the same thing, but on more of a massive scale and more of like a business service or something like that, like say through an app or something like that. So you kind of you get people to sign up for it, and you'll provide them with the service, so the app would I could go into the detail, but that's not what's important here. Is we'd kind of, you know, we would help people who weren't signed up for our service as well, and we'd kind of give them a quote unquote ticket, but it would actually just be a little advertisement for our service. Mm-hmm. So say, hey, you would have gotten this ticket, but we're providing the service for you. And kind of to build a bigger thing of that, because I only know of that happening in Keene, New Hampshire, and I know that there's lots of people all over the place who would be interested in that for a multitude of reasons, whether or not they're just selfishly wanting to not pay parking tickets or whether or not that's selfish is up for debate. But, you know,
the reason why it happened the way it did in Keene, New Hampshire is because we have activists who've moved here from all around the country, liberty-minded people, whether they move for the Free State Project or Shire Society, people are coming to New Hampshire. And that's why we have the activist resources, the human resources on the ground to be able to actually staff fairly often, like on an almost daily basis, at its peak. It's not at its peak anymore, but when it was at its peak, it was 6 days a week, several hours per day. We had Robin Hooders out on the streets. Now, mostly, you know, it was being funded by people who really appreciated what was going on with Robin Hooding, essentially a self-funded operation. And if you could find a way to generate revenue on a more consistent basis by having people subscribe via an app, I think that would be great. But then again, you'd also have to guarantee people, I think, that they would get saved right at that point. And if not, then you'd then pay their ticket for them, that kind of thing. I think it's an interesting idea. Obviously, it requires customers to have an app, which, you know, I don't know how that – I guess you'd probably, GPS that you're parked in a certain location, and then the Robin Hooder would sort of know who's parked where, that kind of thing?
Yeah, and you could say, like, well, I put 2 hours in this meter, and I'll check in right now, and I'll check back in. And if I don't check back in within, say, an hour, it would pop up on, like, our admin app saying, like, oh, this turns into a yellow light. Like, you have an hour to make sure this car doesn't get a ticket, and say, like, once it gets down to – 20 minutes or 15 minutes, like it's red or something like that. I mean, I had the idea when I was pitching it to my girlfriend, actually, like of it being like a donation activist kind of thing, but she was kind of giving me a reality check and saying, well, that's not going to happen.
Yeah, it sounds like an awful
people here.
Awful lot of effort to go into and an awful lot of programming and capital investment in order to do something that would probably never get you any return on your investment, especially in a place like Keene where we're putting in nickels to avoid $5 tickets. It seems like a lot of effort.
You're asking a lot of the customer, essentially, to download the app, to use the app, to remember to pull out the app when they drop a quarter in a meter or whatever.
Plus, I don't want people to act
actually believe that they are going to get saved by the Robin Hooders. I think that becomes counterproductive because at that
then
point,
they expect
there's plenty of people that are like, huh, I guess I don't pay for parking meters no more here in Keene.
Well, I guess that would be the idea behind the program, right? Like to actually make profitable to stop people from having to pay for. Yeah, I guess I see what you're saying.
Though. I mean, you know, I run a podcast where we ask people to send money if they like it, and far fewer than what 5%, maybe 1% do that.
Are we talking about 1% of the online listenership?
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't want to run
it's
a business
more like 10, probably 5 to 10% of the online listenership, but as far as our radio listeners and other people listening on satellite, they're not doing that.
Yeah,
it's probably less than 1%. Yeah,
I couldn't tell you precisely, but I don't want those kind of I don't want to try to replicate those kind of numbers in a real brick and mortar business where there's overhead.
But at the same time, I don't want to talk you out of it. I mean, if you've got a bunch of money to burn developing a cool Robin Hooding app and you want to start up a business that would somehow do the things you're suggesting, then I say go for it. Unfortunately, in the activist world, we don't have a bunch of money to burn on things like that. So I mean, we're fairly low budget on much everything.
Check out Kick. Sidekick, spelled K-I-K, not K-I-C-K.
What is that?
It is an app where it's in development, but if he wants to get in a development team, I'm sure they'll help him out. It's an app where you pull it out, you touch the button, it begins recording, and besides that, and uploading that to a secure server, that kind of thing. But besides that, it also lets a bunch of lawyers the lawyers know in the area that hey, there's a situation, and the first one that jumps on then can interact with the police, and you don't have to speak to them. And that's a pretty nice thing.
You know what?
Also, you should check out Peacekeeper. It's another app where it's an emergency situation. You push the button, and your network gets to find out there's some kind of emergency at your house.
Right. The idea at first was, some sort of altruistic thing. But of course, like Chris was saying, it's kind of out of the question if you think that I don't have lots of money to put down towards this. But, it was just an idea, and I thought I'd pitch it to you guys.
Here's what you might want to look into. I mean, Mark, those were good suggestions. But actually, in his sort of area of interest, there's a guy who actually came to Keene about a year back. His name is Dennis, and I'm not going to try to pronounce his last name. But he is he's the creator of an app called MeterAid, MeterAid, MeterAid. It is actually an app about that is supposed to help people kind of track their meter use and in theory it could also track the locations of the parking enforcers and things like that. So there actually is a parking related app that is made by a good guy, from what I can tell, somebody who actually supports the Robin Hooders. So maybe he's actually already doing some of the things you're talking about. That I think would be the most useful thing for you to look into, Fred. It's MeterAid. So check them out.
Sweet. Thanks a lot, guys.
Thanks.
And like Mark was saying, save a $5 ticket. I don't know. I don't live in Keene, New Hampshire, but we sure get higher than $5 tickets.
Everybody else does, yeah.
Parking violations.
Thanks for the call tonight, Fred. I appreciate hearing from you. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Speaking of the parking rates here in Keene, the $5 ticket, there was a proposal on the table in 2014 by one of the city councilors to double the rate to $10. There was a fair amount of pushback from people in the community on that. There was actually activists who went around and got signatures from people, both business owners on Main Street. There was one petition for the business owners and another one for just average folks. And so there were 30-plus business owners who signed saying, do not raise these rates. It's already hurting our business as is. We don't need these rates to be raised. And then hundreds of people signed the average folks petition. And that seems to have been taken off the table. The city council never came back with the firm proposal.
I think that's, that's where they should actually look to make the parking better here in Keene. Is the fact is that property taxes are being used to subsidize parking, and that's wrong. If you want to park somewhere and charge people for it, that the cost of people parking should support that.
Toll-free number tonight is 855-450-FREE. More coming up. It's Free Talk Live.
Indefinite extension of the human lifespan is coming. But is it coming soon enough for you and me? That's the $80,000 question. I say $80,000 because that's what it costs to have your head cryonically frozen by Alcor. I've committed to do it. I got a life insurance policy, and I made them the beneficiaries. Bam, my best shot at living forever. Interested? Contact them at alcor.org. ALCOR.org. Mention my name and I get a free year of membership.
How fast are new Allegra gel caps?
I didn't know you got a cat fast.
How strong are new Allegra gel caps?
10 more logs to go strong.
Non-drowsy Allegra gives you noticeable relief of your toughest allergy symptoms in just 1 hour. 2 times faster than Claritin and stays strong for 24 hours.
It's relief when the pollen's off the charts strong, even in the convertible.
New Allegra gel caps. Nothing's faster. Nothing's stronger. Guaranteed or your money back. Visit Allegra.com. Use only as directed.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Boost Kit Essentials Nutritionally Complete Drink, providing your picky eater with essential nutrition and great taste in one drink. Visit us at kitessentials.com. To make sure your kids eat healthy, follow the 5-a-day plan. Serve 3 servings of vegetables and 2 servings of fruit daily. Remember, a serving could just mean a piece of fruit or a half cup of veggies. If your kids are picky eaters, ask a nutritionist about other sources. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number 3 is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates. Online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. Gold opened today at $1,148, down $2. Silver opened at $15.51, down 5 cents. And Bitcoin is trading around $272.55. Today's precious metal prices are brought to you by Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. In the news, New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio has announced an expansion to a pilot program that uses gunshot detector audio recorders in an effort to respond to crime. The program will cost $1.5 million to install 300 devices around the precincts with the highest rates of gun violence. The devices are already live in the Bronx and should be in operation in Brooklyn soon. The ShotSpotter program records noises believed to be gunshots and then relays the information to police officers. A New York Supreme Court judge has ruled that the Erie County Sheriff's Office must comply with public records requests for Stingray cell phone surveillance. The NYCLU sued the Sheriff's Office after the department failed to respond to requests regarding how the devices are used. Judge Patrick McNoyer sided with the NYCLU and ruled the Sheriff's Office must hand over the data. NYCLU staff attorney Mariko Hirose said the decision confirmed that law enforcement cannot hide behind a shroud of secrecy while it's invading the privacy of those it is sworn to protect and serve. On March 11th, Texas State Representative Dwayne Bohack introduced a bill that would require warrants for the use of Stingray cell phone surveillance and remove secrecy granted by nondisclosure agreements. House Bill 3165 would require law enforcement to obtain a warrant before the use of cell site simulators or Stingrays, which covertly gather cell phone data through cell towers. The bill would require an authorized peace officer to sign a sworn affidavit that details the name, department, and address of the applicant, the cellular device to be monitored, the name of the owner, and the facts of probable cause for the warrant. The bill would also prevent the state from withholding information based on confidentiality from nondisclosure agreements or other contracts. If passed, the bill would go into effect on September 1, 2015. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by Central Texas Gunworks, your online source for firearms, firearm accessories, and ammunition. They take major credit cards and now accept Bitcoin. Visit them online at shop.centraltexasgunworks.com. This is the Liberty Beat for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. Check out the website at thelibertybeat.com. The leadership of the Presbyterian Church on Tuesday voted to change the definition of marriage in the church's constitution to include same-sex marriage. The New York Times reports the Constitution will change the definition of marriage from being between a man and a woman to two people, traditionally a man and woman. The change was approved by a majority of the church's 171 regional bodies, finalizing a change recommended by the church's General Assembly last year. Tomorrow, Aboriginal Australians will rally to protest the forced closure of Aboriginal communities within Western Australia and efforts to remove Aboriginal people from their homelands. Prime Minister Tony Abbott and Premier of Western Australia, Colin Barnett, have stated that the state can no longer subsidize 150 Aboriginal communities. The communities have issued a global call to action, declaring that it is their intrinsic fundamental human right to live in their traditional lands. Researchers with the Open Sustainability Technology Group at Michigan Technological University have developed a less costly way to recycle plastics to be used for 3D printing. Joshua Pierce and his team released a paper detailing how they were able to reduce the price of resin filament by using a RecycleBot. The team hopes to make 3D printing recycling a widespread practice. Looking to promote your business or cause to tens of thousands of loyal listeners? Well, for a limited time only, the Liberty Beat is offering you the chance to say big while spreading your message. It's simple. Just sign up for 3 months of advertising and get your fourth month free. Don't miss out on this unique opportunity. Just visit thelibertybeat.com/advertise and use coupon code GCN in the Describe Your Company section. This is the Liberty Beat for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. I'm Brian Hagan reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
In local news, 23-year-old graffiti artist Adam Zane has captured the heart of 19-year-old college sophomore Jessica Tisolo. Zane, who goes by the graffiti handle Slice, met Tisolo last summer at an annoyingly self-aware dive bar where the talentless artist caught Tisolo's eye with his cliched sleeve tattoos of trite Japanese imagery and the fact that he was wearing a winter hat indoors in the middle of June.
His art is really just the absolute worst. I think we're going to get married someday.
And now for This Week in Tech, brought to you by LG. An excited groom sends text messages to his buddies during his bride's vow. And a collection of VHS tapes are held onto for one more year. In other news, a burglar makes sure to crack the glass on a family portrait before leaving. There's nothing in the employee handbook about groping dead co-workers, an employee says. And a report finds that nobody's heard from David Blaine in a while, so somebody should probably check to see if he died in one of those things. Mere seconds have passed, yet we feel as though we've known you 1,000 lifetimes. For more, visit theonion.com/newsbeat.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live, dial toll-free to bring up anything that you want here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. You can join us online at freetalklive.com. Enjoy the features that are waiting for you there. Once again, that's freetalklive.com. With you tonight, you've got me, Ian.
Cantwell.
And Mark.
And, of course, you can join us on Skype. Our Skype username here is lrn.fm, so feel free to reach out that way, because generally you'll sound a lot better if you do so. So again, toll-free number 855-450-FREE. Mark, you've got something to share with us this evening. Apparently, some politician here in this country wants mandatory voting.
Well, it's Barack Obama.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, the system would obviously be better if some people who self-selected to opt out of the voting process, perhaps because of ignorance or, you know, whatever reason it might be, would be forced to vote.
It was interesting that this is news to me. I just watched his interview. I normally don't watch anything that presidents do, whether it's George Bush or Barack Obama. To me, they're all just criminals. They're the top dog of a
most
big criminal
successful
gang.
Criminal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I watched this interview because it was done by Vice, and I find Vice to be a very interesting group doing, you know, reporting that's unusual in the scheme of media out there, frequently focusing, well, on Vice and other things of interest. So I thought it would be interesting to see what kind of questions the Vice producer who was putting this together, who's like the main guy at Vice, would ask Barack Obama. Most of it was fairly, you know, uninteresting. But the very end question was actually about marijuana legalization, and his answer was, well, I'll say it left something to be desired, I guess. He, you know, had the chance to really kind of own this, which, of course, he's never really done, so why would he do it now? at this point. Even though you could argue that he's now on his way out, lame duck presidency, why not, you know, go ahead and do the right thing on this issue. Essentially, Vice confronted him with this, saying this was the most requested question. The question that they were receiving from their audience at Vice.com was about marijuana legalization. He suggested to Barack Obama that this could be a real legacy for him if he actually presided over legalizing marijuana. And Obama sort of, you know, threw out a couple of things to placate people by saying that, you know, the system is punishing nonviolent drug users, and that shouldn't happen.
It's not the system. You are the system, dude.
And, you know, he said that that shouldn't happen. But then he was like, do we legalize heroin? Do we legalize cocaine? Do we legalize, you know, this?
Nobody asked you about heroin.
Amphetamine, the whole nine, as I told the New Hampshire legislature.
Yeah. So he
I'm fine with legalizing those things, but no one asked him that question. Yeah. I mean,
so he
if you wait
like
a second. I mean, well, why don't we just make tobacco and alcohol illegal? I don't know where this arbitrary line got drawn that marijuana's on one side of. If you go back and look in history, it has a lot to do with newspaper magnates owning pine tree forests and the fact that people didn't like the fact that Mexicans smoked it. I mean, it was very arbitrary.
So he sort of dodged around the question and made it sound like he couldn't reschedule the drug himself. I thought he could.
I tell you what he could do. He could go ahead and release every nonviolent marijuana drug possessor that's in federal prison right now, and I'll bet you that sent a big old message to Congress.
Oh, yeah.
Like, you know, hey.
That's not going to happen.
That's the bully pulpit. You're just a wimp. That's what he is. I mean, he doesn't mean it.
And I am wholly uninterested in Barack Obama claiming that he doesn't have the power to do things. That guy has issued plenty of executive orders that are wholly outside of his authority. He could tell the DEA to stand down anytime he wants.
Right. And he could fire them all.
Yeah, he might, even if he, I don't know if he can actually change the scheduling of drugs. I do believe that that's a power of Congress. The DEA is not only going out and busting people for marijuana. The DEA is executive branch. He can order the DEA to do or to not do things. And in addition to the war on drugs as it stands, the DEA is going out and arbitrarily banning substances all the time because they are synthetic cannabinoids and whatnot, and going out and raiding people who are selling products that they perceive to be legal. So I am so uninterested in him saying, well, you know, the Constitution really ties my hands on this one. Go to hell.
He didn't mention the Constitution.
He also was recently quoted in saying essentially that that young people should be less worried about the legalization of marijuana and more worried about world peace and stuff. You're the one dropping bombs on people. Stop trying to shed responsibility.
That was actually the first part of his answer. When he was asked the question about marijuana, he was like, well, young people should, because the guy conducting the interview said that, you know, most of his audience is younger. And that's where these questions were coming from. And sort of the whole conversation was about what young people's issues are. And so that's when Barack Obama was saying, well, young people should be concerned with this and this and this and this. And, you know, went down a list of other things that he thought was more important. So he essentially told all of the people who thought this was the most important issue, your issue is junk. It's not important to me. And this is what you should find important. He was just basically slapped them all in the face, essentially, with that answer.
Well, there's issues that I find less important and more important. And marijuana is not the top issue for me. But what I've found is that if I want to create coalitions with people, that I'm going to have to advocate for, liberty on every issue every time. Yes, there's some issues that I'm, you know, and some of them I'm just not going to take a stand on. It's just not important enough for me to take my time. But when it comes to marijuana, you can take a look at the drug war, and largely the drug war is the war on marijuana, just historically, because it's big, it's bulky, it's stinky, and a lot of people use it. And if you look at that, at the drug war, you'll see that that's a war on the Fourth Amendment. So if you care about the Constitution of the United States, you should be against the drug war. But so many people aren't. And this is the reason that I decided, I'm going to have to take this stand.
So, Mark, the reason I kind of went into that as a sidetrack was because one of the other questions that he answered during this, what was about an 18-minute long interview, after that was edited, I guess. But one of the other questions was asked where he was kind of talking about how there's this gridlock in Congress and, you know, they can't get anything done, sort of typical claim. And he then bemoaned that there aren't that many people who are voting.
Yeah.
He bemoaned the idea that You know, there are these people out there who just, you know, they're not voting for the Democrats. They're not voting at all. They should vote, and they should vote for the Democrats, is essentially his position. He, you know, painted Republicans as sort of behind the times, but then suggested that the apathy was what was really allowing the Republicans to continue to get elected, and that if only more people voted, they would vote Democrat. And now you're saying that he's actually advocating for mandatory voting?
Well, it's not uncommon for Democrats to want more people to vote. Essentially, when you see elections, that when you get people out to vote, that they, you know, the larger the turnout, the better it tends to be for Democrats. This says one of two things about Democratic voters, that they are either A, lazy, or B, less informed. I mean, usually people are going to opt out, or I suppose you could say C, that they understand that in some election that you know, votes are statistically insignificant. But I tend to think if they're going and voting in presidential elections, no. I mean, basically, presidential elections get more people to go because there's just so much hype about them. They go on and on and on for month after month, just pounding in your head. Oh, this guy's terrible. Oh, that guy's terrible. Watch out for them. And then finally, you know, they culminates in this day, and it's just over, thank God. And they've picked one of the two, you know, deadbeats, one of the two criminals, and, you know, so it's 4 more years of that, and the likelihood of them getting kicked out of 4 years is pretty slim, so it's mm-hmm. really 8 years. So, anyway.
All right, so what's the news?
From the AP, they said the only two things that are certain in life are death and taxes. Barack Obama wants to add one more thing, voting. Obama floated the idea of mandatory voting in the U.S. while wow. speaking to a civic group in Cleveland on Wednesday. He asked about today's Wednesday, the corrosive influence yep. of money in U.S. elections. Obama digressed into the related topic of voting rights and said that the U.S. should be making it easier, not harder, for people to vote. Just ask Australia, where citizens have no
there.
Choice but to vote, the president said. There are some ways to opt out, but yeah. It's
how do you opt out? In Australia.
I'd have to look.
Religious objections?
I'd have to go and look again, but I suspect religious objections there.
Yeah, like I object to voting for evil,
yeah,
for instance.
And something like that, yeah. I suppose you could do. And I suppose that's, for voting for evil is really more of a philosophical objection, I suppose. Anyway, if everybody voted, then it would be completely, it would completely change the political map in this country. That's true. Obama said, calling it potentially transformative. Not only that, Obama said, but universal voting would counteract money more than anything. How would it do that? I mean, you'd still want the
that
politicians.
Doesn't make sense.
It would still want to influence the way people voted.
I want to hear more. There's more?
Yeah.
All right, 855-450-FREE. Would you do it if you're a current non-voter and they passed this universal voting, as he's calling it, mandatory voting? Would you do it? Or would you commit civil disobedience? 855-450-FREE. 855-450-3733. Free Talk Live.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGDirect.com.
It takes a lot of courage to face your own death, but I'm glad I finally did. See, I was putting off getting life insurance to protect my family, even though I knew it was important. Then my neighbor's husband died. I watched her struggle emotionally and financially. It really made me face reality. If my husband died, how would I pay the mortgage, the car payments, or keep up the life the kids and I had? I realized I needed to get us life insurance right away. So I called AIG Direct. In less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing my family has protection.
Call AIG Direct right now for a free, no-obligation quote. The call takes less than 5 minutes, and you can save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-463-9184. That's 1-800-463-9184. 1-800-463-9184.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
Farmers keep livestock lean and healthy with a mineral-rich diet. Then, before market, they cut off minerals, leaving them to crave high-calorie grains. If weight control is this easy, why prescribe surgery for humans? Introducing Youngevity. You could avoid 900 diseases by getting 90 essential nutrients from Youngevity. Check out 90 for Life at tobeyoungagain.com or call 855-79-YOUNG. That's 855-79-YOUNG or tobeyoungagain.com. Youngevity. It's all about saving money, getting healthy, and creating wealth.
Free Talk Live.
Who is playing dress up as a guess?
Superhero.
Ninja.
A border ninja.
See, that would be the problem. Somebody else would dress up like a pirate, and then there would be a war.
Yeah. Just the pirates duking it out.
Wait, well, now what do the pirates have against ninjas?
Ninjas and pirates are like matter and antimatter. They can't be together.
Okay.
I have a feeling the ninjas would just whoop it up on the pirates.
Man. Are you kidding? Pirates. Pirates, man.
Oh, the pirates do have cannons. They have the long-range attack ability, but once you get in close...
It's hard to be tougher than a pirate, though.
The pirates are certainly tough, but the agility I don't think is there.
Lose
they sit around on a
lose
ship
a hand,
day.
Lose a leg. You can still get 200 people to be afraid of you as you stomp around with half of your, you know, an eye patch, one hand, one leg. You stomp around half a person, and you're still commanding 200 people.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. If they made voting mandatory, if they made it so there might be some sort of penalty if you don't go and vote, and I would be very, very interested. I doubt the article you have, Mark, suggests... But I would be very interested in hearing what the penalty would be proposed to be. Apparently, Barack Obama proposing what he describes as universal voting, meaning everyone who is of a certain age, at minimum, must vote in what I presume are at least national elections or maybe all elections. So we'll hear more about the proposal here in a moment. But for me, and I do vote... I don't really care much about national elections, but I do vote in New Hampshire's elections. This would make me not want to actually participate. Or maybe I would just participate in the New Hampshire ones and swear off ever casting a vote in national elections.
Is it my understanding you can go in and then just not vote for people?
Really?
You can get like the
sheet.
So you
have to show up?
Yeah. It's like roll call at school.
It's ridiculous.
Oh, yeah. It's a mess. There's no doubt about it.
It's funny to me because I was recently just like clashing with my audience. You know, I announced that I joined the Libertarian Party and have sort of like been talking more about politics lately, and all of the ANCAPs that I've just been feeding raw meat to over the years are all like, "What are you doing? You're a status sellout."
And you I'm like, traitor.
Well, and I'm like, "Well, you know, look, I'm on the ground here trying to, you know, effect some sort of change. If you guys want to pick up your guns and start the revolution, then by all means come up here and join me, but I'm sick of listening to you whine on the internet, right?" Mm. And so I'm saying to them, I had Wes Benedict on the show and I was talking about the Libertarian Party. Yeah. And, you know, we're pointing out that like, look, you think that not voting is doing something. There's plenty of countries where you can't vote or where everybody knows the election is a sham and the government maintains its quote legitimacy anyway. So what do you think it is? You know, people say by voting, you're perpetuating faith in the system and whatnot, and that you should not be voting if you're a principled anarchist or whatever. And I'm like, well, you know, I've I've run with that line before, but I don't think it to be terribly useful.
And yeah, I don't get it either, because the fact is that not voting wins just about every single election in the U.S.
Yeah.
More people don't vote in most elections than do vote, and that's not even counting which side they vote for.
Right.
So if there's a side, not voting tends to win, and the government keeps on getting bigger. So the best argument is that not voting grows the government, because we can look at most elections, people don't vote. Most elections, after most elections, the government tends to grow, so therefore not voting grows the government. I don't actually believe that, because I don't believe you're responsible for it if you don't vote, but I mean, good Lord. Yeah. It's not a solution to anything.
Let's talk to Richard in Omaha. Richard, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Chris Cantwell, and Mark.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, when you talked about people going out to vote, With this president in office, when he first was running for office, this was the first time in all the years of voting where actually I had to, how you call it, bow out of voting that first time with this guy, because would you believe that morning I was getting ready to go out and vote, and the next thing I know, somebody's pounding on my door that everybody should get out to vote, and then within a half hour after that, another pounding on the door, and I open it up, and six people are right at my door saying, "Are you going out to vote, sir?" And I just slammed the door real fast, and I says, "Go goodbye."
Wow, so, they don't do that in my neighborhood.
Jeez, this is in Nebraska.
And I did report it though to the election office. And reported to him, and they said it happened so far to one other people.
Yes, the Jehovah's Democrats is my understanding.
Richard, anything else you want to share tonight?
Yeah,
that's just what I wanted to let you know.
Thank you for the call tonight. I appreciate hearing from you.
Next thing, it'll be a SWAT team.
Don't give them any ideas, Chris Cantwell. I mean, they are talking about mandatory voting here. So, Mark, tell me more about
this. They're extolling the virtues of mandatory voting. Obama's extolling the virtues of mandatory voting in Australia, where it's a $50 penalty if you miss voting.
Well, he's not extolling them. He's actually calling for this to be implemented, right? He's saying this should happen.
I mean, I think he's saying that, but I mean, it's not like he's proposed
it. Yeah, it's not a bill before Congress at this point. He's saying to people, hey, this would be a wonderful policy at some sort of speech that he's giving.
Yeah, he's in Cleveland talking to people. He's not.
Would it be constitutional if they actually made mandatory voting?
You can conscript people into war. You can conscript them into a voting vote.
Yeah, I don't know why you even asked that question. The fact is that when you ask that question, what you point out is that the system in the United States is controlled by five people.
Mm.
By its very nature, the Supreme Court, five out of the nine people, and yes, the Supreme Court can be larger or smaller, I know that.
Mm-hmm.
But currently, five people decide whether laws are valid or not. And that's a real mess, frankly. I think it's ridiculous. So it doesn't matter whether I think it's constitutional or not. I don't think the vast majority of things that are going on are constitutional. But there's a bunch of people in black moo-moos out there that disagree with me. Going on. Disproportionately, Americans who skip the polls on election day are younger, lower income, and more likely to be immigrants or minorities.
They're also more likely to be at work.
Yeah. This is what Obama said. There's a reason why some folks try to keep them away from the polls, he said in a veiled reference to the efforts in a number of Republican-led states to make it harder for people to vote. Statistically speaking, but also on the other side of that, there's plenty of efforts from the Democrat side to allow people to vote more than once. I mean, here in New Hampshire, there's the accusations have flown from many of the people who are, in charge of the voting that, yes, we've reported it to the state's attorney guy or whatever they are, and they want nothing to do with these cases. They don't look at them. So I wouldn't doubt that happens in other states, too. I would suspect New Hampshire's worse because it's the first in the nation for the—
I've heard both of the sides are engaged in voter fraud in New Hampshire.
I'm certain that anybody, people who are seeking political power have a great deal of incentive to engage in voter fraud. I told the elections committee in Concord, they're saying, well, voter fraud is so low here, we don't really have to worry about this. And I'm like, that means that you're really bad at detecting it.
Mm.
Because people go to extraordinary lengths to steal a couple of bucks. If you don't think there's infinitely more incentive to steal political power, people are out of your minds. So when I go up there, I'm all for trying to increase ballot access that you can get more more candidates on the ballot. But when I go before the Elections Committee, I do everything in my power to set voting rights back a century. I am. Oh, I do not want more people voting.
Look, okay, I don't want more people voting, but I don't want them discriminated against on based on age and gender.
I will discriminate on every single possible characteristic that I possibly can, except for you're a libertarian.
I'd like to remind people that the byline on your website is at ChristopherCantwell.com is...
Anarchist, atheist, expletive.
There you go.
A-hole.
That's right. It's yeah. A-hole. Anyway, going on. Statistically speaking, Obama is correct. Less than 37% of eligible voters cast ballots in the 2014 midterms. According to the United States Election Project, a Pew Research Center study found that those avoiding the polls in 2014 tended to be younger, poorer, less educated, and more racially diverse. At least two dozen countries have some form of compulsory voting, including Belgium, Brazil, and Argentina. In many systems, absconders must provide a valid
and
excuse.
And probably North Korea.
Or face, yes, everybody has to vote for the same guy.
Right.
Or excuse or face a fine, although a few countries have laws on the books that allow for potential imprisonment.
Yeah, I was going to say, what happens when you don't pay the fine? Usually that's jail.
Yeah, it's going to be a fine. It's
usually it's jail when you don't pay the fine.
Yeah.
More coming up here in moments. Where's the story coming from, by the way?
ABC News.
ABC News. All right, more on the way here. You can share your thoughts with us. Mandatory voting. If it became mandatory, would you do it? Because it would make me less likely to vote. 855-450-FREE.
So who else will you meet at the Get Prepared Expo? For starters, from Republic Broadcasting, John Moore and John Statmiller. From GCN, Aaron and Brad Dakins, Joyce Riley, and me, Vincent Finelli. Joining us are the instructors whom you've learned to trust. Surgeon of the Year, Dr. Norman Shuley. Engineer, Matt Stein. The real Fox Mulder of the X-Files, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Author and analyst, Captain John Reagan. Your counterterrorist from Central America, Mike Ma. Dental center owner and my dentist, Dr. Howard Shane. Radiation instructor, Craig Douglas. Author and survivalist, Rich Sheban. Author, Judy Dollarhite. Cancer center owner from Mexico, Dr. Patrick Vickers. Bug out expert and pilot, Captain Bill Sermo. Beekeeper, Jeff Maddox. Seedsman, Mike Knox. Author, Gayla Pruitt. Author, Harry Cooper. Food expert, Joe Acapinti. And Bill Whaley, the junk man. March 27, 28, and 29. GetPreparedExpo.com, the largest preparedness and survival expo in the USA.
Hi, I'm Derek J. To me, an activist's calling is to actively work to advance a cause. The cause for which I work is personal freedom. I believe my life is best when I engage in voluntary interactions and self-government. I reject the idea that anyone else has a higher claim to my life or my body than I do. I see people who call themselves the government as a threat to my personal freedom. I realize you may feel differently, but my relationship with the people who call themselves the government is completely involuntary. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at VictimlessCrimeSpree.com. That's VictimlessCrimeSpree.com.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate, well, I know a guy who's really great. It's the Realtor Mark Warden. You want a home with 20 acres, a lakeside cabin, any takers for renters, buyers, and sellers too. Mark Warden is the guy for you. PorcupineRealEstate.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
Due to an upturn in the economy, Main Street Business Loans has pre-approved the release of millions of dollars in small business funding. Your business may already be pre-approved to receive up to $250,000. We've sent out millions of pre-approval letters.
We see the economy growing, and our underwriters believe now is the time to invest in your business so you can grow faster and make more money. And we're prepared to give you up to $250,000 to do it. Your funds can be available in 5 days. There are no application fees, no annual fees, just quick access to up to $250,000. If your business did not receive your approval letter to get up to $250,000, call Main Street Business Loans Approval Desk now.
800-430-4505. 800-430-4505. 800-430-4505. That's 800-430-4505.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
Welcome back to Free Talk Live. We'll take your calls about anything. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Of course, you can join us online over at freetalklive.com. If they make voting mandatory in the United States, would that make you less likely to vote? That's certainly how I am. I would not want—I mean, first of all, I'm not really interested in the federal government at all. But if there was a race where there was a Libertarian running for Senate or something like that in New Hampshire, I would still want to vote for the Libertarian if I had that opportunity. That hasn't really happened because it's next to impossible for third parties to get on the ballot here in New Hampshire. But if that were to happen, that would be the only circumstance I could really find myself voting in a national election, is if there actually was a Libertarian to vote for. But if they're mandating that I vote in national elections, that would make me less likely to do it. And this, the proposal apparently on the table from Barack Obama. Now, he hasn't put forth any legislation yet to, you know, his buddies in the legislature. But, you know, maybe that's coming. Maybe they're actually going to try for this.
Yep.
Oh, sorry about that, Chris. Let's try that again.
Yeah, you guys just shut me down.
I don't know what the hell I'm doing here.
Right? You know, in the first segment, it made sense. You guys are talking to the CH1 guy.
Well, you weren't actually muted in the first segment. There was some sort of technical gaffe, and I don't know what that was. That was human error in that case.
All right.
This time.
Well, I'm glad to be back with you,
ChristopherCantwell.com, your website, by the way. I'd like to mention that.
Sure is, yeah.
What's going on there right now?
I posted an article today. We had some trouble recently in New Hampshire. There were a couple of people who had come in from out of town, who had moved here, and I had actually welcomed them quite warmly, and they ended up being quite the problem. But then there were some folks who, you know, pointed out that they were a problem, and I didn't believe those folks right away because they have been known to be whiny little hand-wringers who complain about everything. And so I wrote a story today. It was a true fable titled "The Libertarians Who Cried Wolf," and that's on the front page right now.
I haven't even gotten to that one yet, so I will definitely check that one out. ChristopherCantwell.com, and that's also, there's a similar story up over at freekeen.com.
Yeah, I linked to your story, because I gave, like, I wrote this as like a fairy tale fable story, right. But it's a true story, and I said, for the details, go check out Ian Freeman's piece at freekeen.com.
Yeah, where you can actually watch about a 2-3 minute video of these essentially provocateurs, for lack of a better term, coming to the local event that we have called Social Sundays, and then proceeding to get themselves kicked out by being such a-holes to people that were there. I mean,
these people give a-holes a bad name, frankly.
Yeah.
And, you know, they had come into town and sort of announced themselves as fans of me and Derek, and they had announced themselves in the Shire Society Forum. And
that's
when
right.
When they came to town.
And they subsequently edited that post, by the way, on the Shire Society Forum, their intro post, where they were talking about how they were moving to Keene. Now it just says "For Anarchy." It used to be a more detailed post about, oh, we're moving to Keene, and you're looking forward to being there, and, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, well, they got here, and, you know, they had come over my house the night that they got there, and we like drank it up. We had a blast. Like, I gave them a shout out on some garbage podcast and everything, and then you would inform me that there were some complaints about them at Liberty Forum and that sort of thing, and
right.
I'm like, well, I'm interested to find out more details, but I'm banned from Liberty Forum, so I don't really care if somebody gets kicked out of Liberty Forum.
Yeah.
It seems to me like Liberty Forum's a bunch of stuffy idiots who might as well have had a Murray Rothbard pinata in the lobby. I was furious with those people. It was a bunch of Koch Brothers parade. So I didn't take it too seriously when they got kicked out of there, and of course there's a lot of people who are hostile to me at the Quill too, so they got kicked out of the Quill and they got kicked out of Liberty Forum, and I'm like, I don't care. You're a bunch of stuffy, whiny hand-wringers. I'm not interested in your opinions. But it turned out they really were scum, and it took us a little while to figure it out because of the libertarians who cry wolf.
Well, and people were upset at me because I wasn't willing to just oust these guys. I mean, I didn't witness the things that were happening at Liberty Forum, but I heard from a lot of people, a lot of different people, that you know they had essentially come there on a Friday night. They were allegedly drunk and were allegedly trying to get someone to hit them, was what I had heard from more than one person.
Well, yeah, and Brett Vinod had posted that, and I said, look, he said they were trying to get beat up. And I was like, is that preemptive victim blaming? Like, who says, like, that's your claim about them is that they were trying to get beat up. I was like, well, what if I came here and said that a woman was trying to get raped? What would people say to me? And, you know, he sort of, you know, shuffled his words around. And I don't take Brett to be a guy who engages in a lot of drama. He seems like a pretty, like, reputable source of information. Yeah. But he's, of course, dating Allie Havens, which is a huge rival of mine who's engaged in a great deal of senseless drama and BS. And I said, okay, well, I gotta sort of discount what I'm hearing here.
So, I mean, I like Allie, but you guys don't get along, and that's just the way it is. But yeah,
and the
so
fussing
continues. I heard from multiple sources that they were, you know, essentially asking people really weird questions as well, like, do you work for the state? That apparently was their opening line, trying to, you know, meet somebody new in the lobby of the
hotel
that we
were at. One of them was trying to get their bottle opened by, will you open my beer bottle?
An underage person. Right, an underage person. There were two of them. One of them was under the age of 21. Right. The other was over the age of 21.
Essentially trying to get people to commit what likely would be a felony, which is to hand an open beer to a minor.
Right. So there were these things that like suggested that either they were you know, undercover agents or informants or something like that, or just totally inept. And so, you know, and so I like to lean towards being forgiving and understanding, and like, look, maybe they were just wasted and they, you know, they made some mistakes. Everybody's done that when they've been, you know, a little bit too drunk. And so I brought them into a group for activists in the Keene area, and I got a bunch of messages from people like, how could you bring them in there? And I'm like, well, you know, let's give them a chance to, you know, make things right. Let's, you know, give them a chance to eat a little crow, apologize for what they did, and, you know, acknowledge that what they did was out of line. And that they should have, you know, taken a more cool level kind of tact towards coming to this event rather than essentially acting like a bull in a china shop and, you know, setting bridges on fire before they've even been completed as far as being built. So they really blew it. And then they proceeded to blow it even further when given the chance to make things right or make good or at least apologize. They just totally just threw everybody in the dirt and acted like they just didn't care. There was an allegation that one of them took a cigarette from a private club in Manchester. The Quill, and the response to that, which I'll admit was funny, wasn't the right response. Damon's response to that, or the guy who calls himself Damon, real name's Jared, but his response was, oh, I FedExed him a cigarette yesterday. And no, he didn't.
Well, and I'll tell you what else too. The fact that you let them into the Facebook group was what eventually got me to throw them under the bus. Okay, because I'm seeing the allegations against them there, and I'm saying to them, I'm speaking,
which never would have happened, by the way. Like, had I not let them into the group, the people who had allegations against them never would have been able to confront them with them. So
right. So I'm speaking to Ashley in the private messenger on Facebook. I'm saying you have to respond to the case being made against you, and Carlos was at least willing to like sort of lay out a detailed case, whereas everybody else was sort of conjecture and rumor and nonsense. And so I'm like, look, this guy is...
Well, Carlos was the guy who was almost about to hit them on Friday night. He was pissed.
Carlos had listed out like a detailed case of what exactly happened. And I said, look, you have to respond to Carlos. I don't care about all of the other idiots in there who are just running with rumors, but you have to respond to what Carlos said.
They never
did. And they're refusing to do it. Well, Ashley had at some point made a response to it that was a couple of paragraphs, but it was nonsense. And that's when I was like, all right, these two, I got to throw them under the bus.
So let's go to your phone calls and thoughts here. If you want to see the video, go to freekeen.com. You want to get Chris Cantwell's perspective, go to christophercantwell.com. It's the top article there right now. But let's go to Chris, listening in Charleston, West Virginia, to WVTS. Hello, Chris.
Hey, guys. How are you?
Good. Go ahead with your thoughts.
Well, just a couple points to point out here. That one, if they want to impose law to make it mandatory to vote and exercise a right, what other rights will they make it law to exercise? And I'm really curious about how the administration would feel about, in particular, Second Amendment rights. If they're going to make a law for mandatory voting, then make it a law for a mandatory Second Amendment right as well.
Yeah, there's a law in, there's a town in Georgia where it's the law that you have to have a gun in your home or something. Like Kennesaw, is that the name of the place?
Yep.
Is that still in effect?
I don't know if it's still in effect, but it's...
I don't think that it's been enforced in quite some time, but I haven't heard a story about the law being repealed anyway.
Chris?
But my thoughts, where does it stop?
That's a good question. Thanks for the call tonight, man. I appreciate it.
If this isn't the most transparent ploy by the Democrats in order to seize power, I don't know what the hell it is. I mean, everybody knows when more people come out, the Democrats tend to win. And when fewer people come out, the Republicans tend to win. I mean, this is transparent bullcrap, and I think it's awful. By the way, Ian, if you would refuse to vote under these circumstances, who would win?
Whoever wins, we lose, whether it's Republicans or Democrats. More coming up. Free Talk Live. Shiny badges on your jacket.
Shiny badges. This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write "worms" in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
You hear that, kid? That's the hum of a well-run facility. You know what I hate hearing? Silence. Silence on a production line means downtime. Downtime means wasted time. Wasted time means wasted money. Silence isn't golden, kid. It's deadly. That's why I love Grainger. With a wide variety of the latest products, Grainger gets us what we need when we need it to help keep this place up and running and humming away. Get it? Got it? Good. Call clickgrainger.com or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
Are you tired of governments murdering people around the world? Stop using their money. There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless, free market, non-political currency. Bitcoin cannot be inflated or controlled by any government. By using their money, you are helping the state. You have an incredible alternative available now. Learn it, use it, spread it. Get started with Bitcoin at weusecoins.com. That's weusecoins.com.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
We've got time for you if you dial right now, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And we were talking about underground marketplaces earlier, the shutdown of Evolution, what was the world's most popular underground marketplace. Now, of course, there are well over a dozen other marketplaces that are selling all manner of different products and services, some of which are very illegal, which you can go and see for yourself. There's actually a dark net monitoring site that keeps an eye on the online statuses.
FBI.gov.
I think it's called D. Oh boy, I had it pulled up earlier, but
DN stats or something.
DN stats or something like that. Whatever. Anyway, so you can look that up on your own. But there's actually a link that I have posted to the Agora Marketplace on the Free Talk Live Facebook, Google Plus, and Twitter. Which, when I posted the link, it was online, and now the site's down again. So they are obviously getting hit hard with traffic now that the number one site's down, and they were the number two site the last time I'd seen the statistics. So go and check that out when you get the chance.
I want to go start like a darknet web hosting service.
How do you do it, or you want to?
I'm saying want to do it, right? Like, what if I have a dedicated server in a data center, right?
Yep.
And prior to that, I had a shared hosting account. My website got too popular. I had to get a dedicated server, right?
Right.
My website was going down. So I wonder, you know, if essentially we had signs outside of the Ross Ulbricht trial saying, you know, so many years of life in prison for hosting a website. Mm-hmm. But of course, it was not that he was just hosting the website. It was an active effort to engage in this market activity. Right. But what if somebody was just in the business of saying, hey, I'm going to give you, a WordPress or whatever that's connected to the dark web. And, you know, you could put whatever you want on it. And I literally have no involvement in it.
Well, right. The server company that was hosting the Silk Road server didn't know they were hosting the Silk Road server. They had plausible deniability.
Yep.
So, you could totally do something like that, I think, and possibly profit from these sites.
Yeah, and I mean, it seemed to me that
and get paid in Bitcoin.
At some point, you're gonna have the infrastructure for these sites is gonna end up in a torrent somewhere, and there are gonna be a mass proliferation of them. And I don't think it's going to be even less successful, the efforts to stop them.
Let's go to Syphase. He's calling from California. You're on Free Talk Live, Syphase.
Hey, first of all, the website you guys are speaking about is dnstats.net.
Thanks,
bud.
I had it up earlier, dnstats.net. Very good. Darknet stats.
Yeah. So you were talking about Bitcoin's multisig feature earlier in the show?
Yeah.
And I just wanted to explain, not on a technical level, but just, you know, as far as how it looks to the user and what it lets you do, I wanted to explain how it works.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, first of all, if these darknet markets were using multisig, you would keep control of all your Bitcoin. So, currently, what a lot of them do is you send the Bitcoins you have on your own device to a wallet where ultimately it is controlled by the market. So, if they get shut down, or if they decide to run with their money, they have the private keys that let them control the money.
Right.
If they were using multisig, the way it would work is basically say that you have Bob, who's the buyer, and Sally is the seller, and they're on some darknet market.
Okay.
The market would create a Bitcoin transaction that says the Bitcoins in this certain account go to Sally if two of the three of us agree. So the three is Bob, Sally, and the market.
Yep.
And they create a transaction saying if two of three of us agree, then the Bitcoins go to Sally. So if Bob and Sally agree that the money should go to Sally, then the market doesn't have to get involved. If they don't agree, that's when the market comes in and
And this is done using the Bitcoin multi-sig protocol, so it can all be done with the exchanging of public keys without having to put money into the underground marketplace.
Well, right. The way it works is that once the transaction is created, each of the three parties would have to sign the transaction to basically agree to it.
Right, and you can sign the transaction through the Bitcoin software without actually doing anything on the Darknet website with money. So you would not have to send Bitcoin to the Darknet site, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
And at this point, it seems to me... At this point, it seems to me that the next market that opens up is going to have to operate entirely that way. This technology existing completely eliminates the need for these escrow services. It completely eliminates the concern of things like we just saw with Evolution. It ends
you'd have
this
to be careful.
Nonsense.
You'd have to be careful, though. And by the way, does the Bitcoin, regular Bitcoin software, the sort of the default software, does that have multisig implemented, or is that only available in some other software?
I do believe it does, and all the software right now, it's pretty easy to do, but it's kind of tedious, and so
which is why people weren't using it.
I don't see the feature in my blockchain wallet on my phone. Yeah. You know? So I mean, there's some other process to it. I heard about multisig for the first time today.
Well, it involves copying. I was reading about it for the first time in detail today as well. The process I was reading about involves copying keys and, you know, that you have to put them in certain areas of certain software, and so there's a process involved in that. Plus, you want to keep in mind.
Yeah. So I mean, you're not copying the keys, you're copying the transaction, basically.
The information about the transaction?
The wallet operators, the blockchain.infos of the world have to get on board and start making this simpler.
Right.
Once this is built into your Bitcoin wallet application, this becomes a much simpler process. We need people like blockchain.info and whoever the other popular wallets are.
Mycelium makes one.
Well, now, even though Evolution did appear to take people's money and run at this point, we don't know what the real story is. They did offer this. They did have the multi-sig as an option. So certain vendors could offer the multi-sig as an option, and then they could also offer standard escrow. But most people would go for standard escrow because it was just simpler. It was easier to do that. But keep in mind, though, if you're not going to be using the Darknet's site and their wallet system, and you're going to be using some wallet that you're actually running on your computer to send money for an illegal transaction on a Darknet, you really need to make sure that whatever Bitcoin wallet you're using has never been associated with your name before. And remember that all Bitcoins are publicly traceable. So you would want to have to use a Bitcoin washing service to send Bitcoin from your legitimate wallet to this sort of other off-the-grid sort of wallet, if you will.
That's not necessarily true. I mean, the way it works right now, you send the Bitcoins from your wallet to the Darknet, and at that point, they do all the anonymizing stuff.
What you do is black marketplace, I think he meant to say. And yeah, I mean, you basically have the same exact problem right now. If you have your wallet that's, listed with your public key and you're giving it to Evolution or Agora Marketplace or something like that, people understand that you're not going there to buy things that you can buy on Amazon.com. I mean, they might not know exactly what transactions are doing exactly what. There's sort of a mix mashing going on the operator site, but people know if you're sending money to Agora Marketplace or Evolution, investigators are able to figure out that you're doing something that your government probably doesn't approve of.
Yeah, but that's the thing. You don't want to send Bitcoin directly to one of those sites. I mean, even if the site is claiming, we'll mix your Bitcoins, you have to trust that they are actually doing that and that they're doing a competent job of it. There are websites out there that do offer that as a service. Now, of course, you have to trust them as well, but you can also, you can go and, I guess, look and see if they are actually being mixed or whatever. But,
there is one more possible issue that could come up. So the way multisig actually works is that first you send the Bitcoins to a specific address, and then to spend from that address, you need to have a multi-sig transaction. So that prevents the dark net from being able to take the Bitcoin.
Right.
But say, for example, they get shut down by the Fed. Normally, those Bitcoins would be stuck because, you know, if you can't contact the buyer or the seller and the market's not there anymore, normally you wouldn't have a way to have two of three people sign and send you back.
Well, in theory, both the buyer and the seller could sign, presuming the transaction got completed in time. And there are other darknet sites. Thanks, SciFace, for the call. There are other darknet sites on which most of those sellers are operating on multiple sites.
And I never heard of deflation destroying an economy anyway.
We'll see you tomorrow night online. In the meantime, check out ChristopherCampbell.com and FreeTalkLive.com. On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on, joined the Free State Project and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
Cop Block Radio is up next, live after the news, on the Liberty Radio Network, LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates, online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. Gold opened today at $1,148, down $2. Silver opened at $15.51, down 5 cents. And Bitcoin is trading around $272.55. Today's precious metal prices are brought to you by Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. In the news, New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio has announced an expansion to a pilot program that uses gunshot detector audio recorders in an effort to respond to crime. The program will cost $1.5 million to install 300 devices around the precincts with the highest rates of gun violence. The devices are already live in the Bronx and should be in operation in Brooklyn soon. The ShotSpotter program records noises believed to be gunshots and then relays the information to police officers. A New York Supreme Court judge has ruled that the Erie County Sheriff's Office must comply with public records requests for Stingray cell phone surveillance. The NYCLU sued the Sheriff's Office after the department failed to respond to requests regarding how the devices are used. Judge Patrick McNoyer sided with the NYCLU and ruled the Sheriff's Office must hand over the data. NYCLU staff attorney Mariko Hirose said the decision confirmed that law enforcement cannot hide behind a shroud of secrecy while it's invading the privacy of those it is sworn to protect and serve. On March 11th, Texas State Representative Dwayne Bohack introduced a bill that would require warrants for the use of Stingray cell phone surveillance and remove secrecy granted by nondisclosure agreements. House Bill 3165 would require law enforcement to obtain a warrant before the use of cell site simulators or Stingrays, which covertly gather cell phone data through cell towers. The bill would require an authorized peace officer to sign a sworn affidavit that details the name, department, and address of the applicant, the cellular device to be monitored, the name of the owner, and the facts of probable cause for the warrant. The bill would also prevent the state from withholding information based on confidentiality from nondisclosure agreements or other contracts. If passed, the bill would go into effect on September 1st, 2015. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by Central Texas Gunworks, your online source for firearms, firearm accessories, and ammunition. They take major credit cards and now accept Bitcoin. Visit them online at shop.centraltexasgunworks.com. This is the Liberty Beat for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. Check out the website at thelibertybeat.com. The leadership of the Presbyterian Church on Tuesday voted to change the definition of marriage in the church's constitution to include same-sex marriage. The New York Times reports the Constitution will change the definition of marriage from being between a man and a woman to two people, traditionally a man and woman. The change was approved by a majority of the church's 171 regional bodies, finalizing a change recommended by the church's General Assembly last year. Tomorrow, Aboriginal Australians will rally to protest the forced closure of Aboriginal communities within Western Australia and efforts to remove Aboriginal people from their homelands. Prime Minister Tony Abbott and Premier of Western Australia, Colin Barnett, have stated that the state can no longer subsidize 150 Aboriginal communities. The communities have issued a global call to action, declaring that it is their intrinsic fundamental human right to live in their traditional lands. Researchers with the Open Sustainability Technology Group at Michigan Technological University have developed a less costly way to recycle plastics to be used for 3D printing. Joshua Pierce and his team released a paper detailing how they were able to reduce the price of resin filament by using a RecycleBot. The team hopes to make 3D printing recycling a widespread practice. Looking to promote your business or cause to tens of thousands of loyal listeners? Well, for a limited time only, the Liberty Beat is offering you the chance to say big while spreading your message. It's simple. Just sign up for 3 months of advertising and get your fourth month free. Don't miss out on this unique opportunity. Just visit thelibertybeat.com/advertise and use coupon code GCN in the Describe Your Company section. This is the Liberty Beat for Wednesday, March 18th, 2015. I'm Brian Hagan reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
A cool guy from middle school is still sporting his fat pair of JNCOs. A stunned St. Peter Square crowd hears the Pope getting bitched out by God, and an eighth grader caked in makeup is probably really confident. This is The Onion Week in Review. This week, a Pew Research Center poll found that the vast majority of Americans would watch a television show called Love Trap, with most saying that regardless of the show's genre or quality, they would tune in weekly to see its stars stumble into romantic triangles, double-cross one another, and contend with whatever the titular Love Trap refers to. The survey confirmed